loving this app. How's everyone's Sunday going?
All right. Give DJ Knox a virtual, digital.
Thank you.
Hand clap there. Message everyone. Everyone, come to the stage. And today for our first panel, we have Miss Joy Valerie Carrera. She's going to be talking about transitioning to remote work, negotiating to get that first remote job right. Welcome, Joy.
Hi, can you hear me?
I can. Okay, let me kick DJ Knots out here. Welcome. So, Joy, you from looking at your LinkedIn and from seeing and following you on Twitter, you're a digital operations and media strategist. I think that you are definitely involved in Black tech, a lot of the movement that's going on in Twitter. I love following you. Give us a quick overview about yourself and let's hop into your discussion.
Yeah, for sure. So I've been in the tech industry for a little bit over, since 2015. That was my first tech job. Before that, I was working in analytics, working in social impacts work and realizing that people were not working in tech, applying any technology in the nonprofit world. Mm-hmm. And really, I was kind of the youngest person everywhere. And people would be like, hey, can you do this or that on the computer? And always thinking to myself, why am I in here? There's no reason for me to be in the office. And I think a lot of us too also face a lot of microaggressions, and it gets very exhausting, to be frank. So I started really sharing my experiences online and connecting with other folks, and wanted to understand more about how the internet made money. So that's really what got me to my first tech job in advertising technology, working on the operations end, while I was trying to learn some web development skills, thinking I'll be a programmer, but realizing there's a lot of other ways to transition into tech, right? And the strategy and operations logistics, that was just the perfect fit for me. And I started at a small tech startup and ended up leading and growing 3 teams and eventually working remotely while being there. And since then, I'm always trying to tell as many people to try to work remotely. Mm-hmm. And then, Corona hit. So a lot of people
are working remotely, yes.
Yeah. But I think, one of the things is everyone's like, oh, that's not doable. And we're seeing that it's being done. And I think a lot more progress is going to come. Mm-hmm. And I think especially for Black and Brown folk, we're definitely going to see a lot more freedom and also flexibility and higher earning potential overall. So I think if we can keep pushing for ourselves to keep pushing into these spaces and, bringing the money to us, but also even helping our fellow people in our community, I think it's better for us overall.
That's amazing. I mean, there's so many different stories and very unorthodox stories in relation to how are getting into tech, how Black and Brown people get into freelancing and remote work. And, these stories need to be told. They are being told, of course. And that's one of the things that, my passion is being able to create an ecosystem and bring those people together, right? And work with everyone else.
For sure.
Doing that. So you came with a presentation. So that's
yeah,
great.
Yeah, just to like keep myself focused, but also keep everyone else focused. Yeah, and I think one of the biggest things is really like using these times, even right now, like to network online. Ironically, no one cared about any of my tech background and will find me through my blog, through my podcast. So I think putting yourself out there and connecting with people online, especially when you don't typically get access to these spaces, like the internet can be such a great tool. So connect with other people here and connect with me. but yeah, I think this is a really good opportunity, especially for our communities.
Well, let's dive into your, PDF and let's go from there. And then after that, we'll open it up with some questions. If you have any questions in the meantime, in the chat, anyone who's watching, then definitely ask your questions and we'll get to it. And you can see the chat also on your end just fine, right?
Yep, so yep, I see everything.
There, and people can, you can, there's an at mention feature, so you can at mention Joey if you need to also to ask your question. So let's dive into it.
Cool. So I'm going to try to go a little bit high level as to assuming that, you know, a lot of people right now have been pushed into tech, into, you know, working remotely. And I just want to start off by saying, like, working at home right now because you're forced to work at home is not necessarily the same as like being able to work remotely full time. I know a lot of people are getting stressed, but maybe, so I just wanted to start with tech is cool, right? So I think tech is also like an avenue that is provides a lot of access and for a lot of us, right? Like I am actually in the country in upstate New York. So, you know, it's already exhausting for me to get into the city. So there's just a little bit more about me and you can find me on LinkedIn, but I'm gonna just dive in because we only have about 30 minutes and mostly focusing on our agenda on your value, how you're managing your time and everything that you're doing, and ultimately leading to financial independence as well as to location independence. And so I started off talking a little bit about myself and my career, right? I was actually going into New York City and commuting 3 hours a day, which was exhausting, into a job. And, you know, I was working in technology, so there really was no need for me to be in the office, given that I was doing a lot of emailing, you know, setting up systems. And there is a benefit to working with people, but as you are all realizing right now, there's a lot of tools that allow us to communicate with our teams all over the world. Eventually, I was leading three teams in India, Poland, and Switzerland, and working with folks with New York and LA. So really showing that, you know, we can work with people distributed anywhere. And so, you know, I started off saying like, did you ever have to actually go into the office? And maybe some of you who haven't been working remotely and have been thrown into this are now thinking like, what was the point of me going in there? And, you know, probably there wasn't a point in you going into the office and a lot of your work can be done remotely. So if you are thinking like, I actually like this, this is giving me a lot more time with my family, with people, maybe a little bit more than you actually want, but thinking long-term, how do I keep this way of life, right? How do I make this a reality? Because at the same time, we're saving money on, you know, having to commute, saving time on those commutes, and actually getting able to have more time for ourselves for the things that we want to do, whether it is, you know, podcasting, blogging, that's kind of what I do now with my free time. But, you know, thinking like, what is the benefit? So I really want to set you guys up to be able to think, what can I negotiate with my current employer and how can I actually set up my time if I'm trying to take on freelance jobs, if I'm trying to eventually transition into working independently, which is kind of what I've done. So, you know, thinking like, what is working from home? It's not what we're doing right now. I know a lot of people are probably like a bit overwhelmed, but, you know, at the same time, you're able to work from the beach when we're, don't do that right now, probably do that after the quarantine is over. But, you know, I think it does allow that flexibility, but you want to really think about it. Like, how does it benefit your employer, right? Thinking about how would you talk to the decision makers? Like, obviously you're probably like, I want to be home. I don't want to have to get dressed up. Maybe I don't want to deal with Susan from the office. Like none of us do, but you want to think about how can I present this in a way that really tells my employer, like, actually this is beneficial and it's a win-win. And I think especially now we have a lot of leverage thinking, all right, everyone is freaking out about the numbers, how their business are doing. And that's really one way that you can start presenting it to your employer as to a benefit that's for you and for them, right? Like maybe you can start telling them what you're doing. So if you're thinking like, I'm just gonna work from home, I'm gonna wake up whenever I want, I'm just gonna hop on here and be in my pajamas and put like minimum effort in. Like obviously take care of yourself. It's a really hard time, but also start prioritizing what you're doing, because right now is when you can start building up a case for yourself in the future if you're already at a job where you can start transitioning out and thinking about what you bring in value, right? So I want to transition this into thinking of how we're going to be measuring that. So we're going to really be measuring this by tracking your deliverables. So if at the least, at the minimum, start thinking like, what did I do today? If you're just like, cool, I emailed some people, I did a couple phone calls, start actually documenting that, because that starts building up the case as to what you can do. And it also keeps you on track, because I know it's very hard when you're at home to think about just time, right? There's no walking over to the water cooler, you know, taking a little break, which you should take breaks, but it's a lot harder to track. So I think one, that keeps you accountable. So also make the case later on, like, listen, I was just as productive as I was at home, as I was in the office, if not more. And start actually tracking your hours. If you want to be like, hey, I woke up at 9, I did this, this, and that, start actually tracking that out so that you can measure and present it to your employer, letting them know, this is what I did within these hours. And maybe it's just for yourself so that you can start managing your time a lot better and seeing how productive you are. So I think this is the biggest case, right? If you're saying like, hey, I actually did, you know, 10% more calls this week, or I got to get through this code 10% more faster, you know, start actually using those data points, right? So really measuring it for yourself, but also being able to tell your employer so that they can transition you to working remotely and, you know, working smarter. And when I think about that, I start to think about time, right? So right now, if you want to focus on one thing, take some notes, start documenting everything that you're doing. I promise you it's going to benefit you mostly in the long run for anything. I want to think about how we're managing your time, right? So this is the hardest part about working freelance, working remotely, even just trying to work on your on your creative projects. So think about how you're segmenting all of your time. So what I like to do is called time blocking. So start thinking like, all right, I wake up at 7 o'clock. I want to right now. I know we're all struggling with this, but thinking like, all right, from 7 to 9 is my traditional routines that I'm doing. From maybe 9 to 11 is when I'm going to start checking all my emails, all of my social media, my DMs, and start really thinking about this, right? Building in time for your lunch, right? And then being like, all right, maybe from 1 to 3 is business development. And say you are out of the job right now, even structuring that out, like 3 to 5 is networking time, start connecting with people via social media, via LinkedIn, via emails. And I think that really starts putting yourself into a routine so that you can really feel more equipped later on when you start taking on these projects. But also if you're working on a project, realizing, okay, this is the time that I block out for, you know, following up with clients or for finishing whatever project that I'm doing. So that way you are on top of what you're doing and feeling more productive. And the second thing that I really want to emphasize is establishing boundaries, because when you're remote, people are not seeing you. So they might think like, I can just hit up Joy whenever I want, right? Like she's just at the computer and calling her at all times. That is the hardest thing about transitioning remote, especially when people have not worked remotely and, you know, they can't come walk over to your desk and be like, hey, what's up? I need an update on this. But I think really segmenting and setting up boundaries with people, being like, hey, you know, let's talk between, you know, 1, 1:20, 1:30, you know, setting fixed times, but also letting, whether it's your clients, whether it's your employer, know that these are the available hours that you can reach me at, and set fixed hours for yourself. Because what actually ends up happening more often than not, and you'll think I'm crazy for saying this, is we end up working too much. Even if you're a freelancer, even if you're working remotely, you know, it's a lot harder, like I said, to track time. And you might end up being like, what? I just worked from like 9 to 8 o'clock. Like, why did I do this when in the office I would be out by 6, right? So I think this is really, really important, establishing boundaries. And that also means having to have those difficult conversations with the person that you are working for, being like, hey, these are my available hours. But I think this makes it a lot easier for yourself. And also, you know where you stand. You know, you'll say like, hey, after 6 o'clock, I'll answer next business day, right? And I think people will respect that more too, and also lets them be able to prioritize their tasks, their projects, and how they communicate with you. That is the hardest part about working remote, if I'm going to be honest. And I think that's something that's a big thing into everyone that you're working with. And you know, the third thing I really want to point out is optimizing your time. So, you know, we got the time blocking going on, and establishing boundaries with clients, employers, people that you're working for, but really thinking about like, let me optimize. So how do we do this? I think more on blocking out, bucketing, right? So if you're just like, everything right now is going to involve data analysis, right? I do a lot of data analysis. So it'll be like, all right, I only want to focus on this. And that makes it a lot easier. So you're not switching back and forth, because when you're working remotely, when you're working by yourself, it gets very overwhelming, especially if you're like me. I have like 3 monitors open. So sometimes I'm like, oh, I was working on writing this. Oh, but wait, I need to fix this code. And then thinking, oh, I need to write a business plan for this. That actually will shift your brain a little bit too much that you can't focus on finishing one thing. So segmenting out to focus on specifically one thing, even if you time yourself. One of the things I like doing is actually setting up a timer and being like, all right, for the next 30 minutes, I'm going to focus on this one thing. And that will make it a lot simpler to actually execute and finish your deliverables. And, you know, thinking about the time that we're leaving for ourselves. So one of the reasons I really advocate for remote work is because we have more time to ourselves. We can focus on not just making money, but also getting to spend time, you know, celebrating ourselves, spending that money in ways that make it beneficial for our lives, whether it's, you know, traveling or, you know, spending time with your family. And I think that's really something that you need to build in into your schedule. Like, I like to build in walks in the morning, right? Or I like to build in doing my creative work, blogging, writing, podcasting. And it's stuff like this that you want to leave time for and separate it out from your work time, because else, you know, it just, you won't have time. And that was the whole point, right? The whole point of you being able to work remotely is to have more flexibility. So these are things that you want to start building. And I literally mean, if you have a Google Calendar, I love my Google Calendar, or a planner, start actually writing it down rather than just keeping it in your head. Because at the same time, you're making more space for all of your projects that you're going to take on. And I know I kind of rushed a little bit through this, and I have a couple more minutes. But the last really big thing on freelancing is, it's a little bit different when it comes to, and I'm teaching you all, or I'm telling you guys from experience, because I just jumped in like, psh, it's gonna be so easy, I could do it, and made a lot of mistakes along the way. So I think the first really big thing is focusing on something, right? If you were like me, I worked at a startup, I was the first employee, I did a little bit of everything. And the mistake that I did is, when I was freelancing, you know, people would be like, I need all of this done. And I was like, sure, cool, let me do all of it for you. And you end up overwhelming yourself and overcommitting to things. So these are things I've learned the hard way. And what I've learned is, you really want to focus in on one aspect that you have enjoyed and are really good at, right? So now I focus just on the operations side and just on the advertising piece, the ad tech piece of, you know, marketing, advertising. And that has helped me focus and zero on and scale up to offer only these one service set. And that's something that you want to start thinking, right? As you're progressing, you know, maybe you are a jack of many trades. I know I am. And sometimes we do have to take on a little bit of different things, but start using that as a way to test out what it is that you enjoy doing more and what you can do that other people might not like doing. Like, I love spreadsheets. I love data analysis. A lot of people don't. And I'm realizing that's my focus set, right? Like, I love the data behind all of the strategic decisions and operations. And maybe you are obsessed over something that people don't traditionally want to do or really need an expert in. So start thinking about what it is that you're going to focus on, because that's the biggest difference versus when you're a salaried employee, you're kind of taking on a lot of different roles. So the other thing that I really want you all to think about is, how do you price yourself, right? This is really hard. One rule that I've kind of adopted is figuring out what your hourly rate is at your previous roles for what you did, similar roles, and thinking of at least doubling or tripling it. And you're thinking like, why not just that main hourly, right? Because you are paying for your own stuff. Oh, I think I'm running out of time.
I'm just, you ready?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. No, I'm closing up. But yeah. So thinking about these things, right, that you want to price yourself at, because you're going to have to pay for your own insurance if you're freelancing, your own, you know, benefits, 401ks. So start adjusting to that and being realistic, right? Like, that's why I kind of wanted to focus first on the documenting and time, because you want to see how much time do you actually have available for yourself and how much time can you start freeing up. So I just really wanted to end on that note. Like, how can you start scaling up? You want to collaborate with other people. Like I said, I do advertising, so I start teaming up with marketers and we take on projects together. And, you know, there's opportunities here on inclusion, the platform, to actually find those. So joining these different platforms that can find them for you, so you're not, you know, taking on that whole responsibility of having to do all the negotiating, the networking, because trust me, it's exhausting. I tried it. Really what I want to focus on is, you know, you guys go off and network while we're here and trying to see who has complementary skills. And yeah, that's basically my quick little talk. And you can stay in touch with me, connect, shoot me a DM, and I'll be hanging around. Thank you so much for this opportunity. Thanks for having me.
Yeah.
Look, and if anyone has questions.
There's so many gems in that. So many gems in that. We do have a few questions. I don't know how to use the direct messaging feature yet. So Ingrid says she direct messaged, sent you a DM, but
Here
too. So she asked, which software helps freelancers track time or block time? So what are you using?
So, okay, this is really bad. I should use a time blocker. I haven't been using these apps just because one of the ones that I was using for contractors was Hubstaff. So that one, though, it helps you more if you're hiring other people. I hadn't been using it for myself, but I really should. And that one has actually helped me see, and it does it more on the types, like typing and being in front of your screen. However, that kind of goes into the pricing, right? So I've done a lot more project-based things versus hourly. So I think that's another thing to consider if you're going to be charging people hourly versus project. So that's why I haven't been measuring as much, but more I block out time for myself, but I haven't charged hourly. So that's a little bit of a difference. So I don't know a particular software.
I'll chime in on that. And I use, because a lot of people are using Asana now for project management to manage tasks, especially around development. But you can kind of use Asana for other things, similar to the way Trello is as well. There's a company called T-Metric that I use for billing for time specifically. But I did hear you mention about using even just leveraging Google Calendar as a way to schedule out your time, these time blocks, right?
Someone mentioned office hours in there, and that's perfect. I think that's key.
And I use Google Calendar as well for like linking it with Calendly, even getting people to schedule. We talk about these boundaries, right? A lot of times people are gonna wanna talk to you, and once in a while you need to block out certain times. And so a great way to do that and to kind of create a way to, as a gatekeeper to your time, is by using Calendly and linking that to your Google Calendar, so that now if someone needs to talk to you, just shoot them the Calendly link over, and they'll see that they can't talk to you from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m., but after 2, you may be available, right? So
yeah, and Calendly, I really love, because even in there, you can set like the blocks, right? So I try to set like one day to take on calls, right? Or a couple hours, just so that I'm in that mindset too of like, right now is call time versus jumping back and forth. So I think that's something that's really important as you're working remotely.
Yeah, exactly. So Coretto said, in some IT teams, I see people making themselves available without limitations, and then they expect it from someone new coming in. So that's a great point there. Let's see, Toggle. Everyone's using Toggle in the chat.
I think they actually have the Asana integration too.
Yeah,
I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, they do. Toggle is a great way to keep as far as time tracking as well. I also use Calendly. So there's a lot of people that are using Toggle and Calendly. And so there's a lot of programs that are out there. I personally use Todoist. Todoist is more so a list. It's a great way to kind of organize your day and organize what you need to get done. It has an app. It has a Chrome extension as well. So it's more of a watered down version of a Trello. It's more simple just for lists. So I've been using that as well. So there's definitely a lot of software suites out there that you can use. What's your number one takeaway? Well, let me ask you this. What was the hardest thing to adjust to in moving from maybe a corporate environment to all the way to freelancing?
Yeah, actually, I think someone's question kind of aligns with that a lot, where it was like, how do you deal when people make themselves ready available? I tried to do that. And I think that was the hardest thing, is really understanding that, like, if you're freelancing, you're not technically an employee, right? Like, you're not salaried. And it's really hard, I think, when you're also, I love what I do, right? So I'm just kind of like, oh, let me do this and that, and really having to set your time apart and being like, all right, this is when you're not paying me for this extra time. But also really establishing those boundaries with people. And it's really about that, right? Like, when their team is working on it, it's like, okay, cool. Like, but that's how they work. And you coming in have to be like, this is how I work. Like, obviously being flexible enough, but being very clear with that, because especially if you're freelancing, people are very excited to be like, cool, we get like the most bang for our buck out of this, right? So they're going to take that extra time, that extra friendliness. And I think for me, it's been a lot harder. It's been hard to adjust, because as a freelancer, I get to pick and choose who I want to work with. So I usually try to like work with people who I enjoy working with, right? But really understanding that, like, okay, after 5 o'clock, that's when we can be friendly and talk and not have to like go into billable hours, right? Essentially. And I think that's been like the hardest part. So really it is about boundary setting. And that's why I kept like emphasizing that and managing your time, because that's been the hardest transition, especially when you go from like, oh, cool, I was on a team and I was chatting with everyone. And then you're like, wait, I'm a freelancer. So like, I can't just be goofing around talking to everybody, right? And I think that's been the hardest part.
Can you share a tip? Because see, freelancing, and when I first launched Inclusion last year, and we had people joining into the marketplace, and people were joining from like Upwork and other places, and they were making money on those like those platforms. And we asked them, well, why did you join? And they said they wanted a community, right? Though they wanted to meet other people. So it's lonely, first of all, in many instances.
Yeah.
And then the other thing is, though, a lot of people are, you know, they are introverts by nature. So networking, reaching out to people, biz dev, what's your best advice for that introvert that has to now find clients?
So I think definitely connecting with platforms like this, because that was actually one of my struggles as well. I'm very bubbly and stuff, but I also love very one-on-one connections. So I am more introverted. But I think not really being afraid to put yourself out there, like on the internet, because the truth is a lot of other folks that are on the internet are just as introverted as you. So I think, you know, not being afraid to say hello. I really leverage Twitter a lot. I think that's how we connected, as well. As you know, basically thinking like, if I were to talk to this person in person, right, how would I, you know, just present myself, right? If you're just gonna like DM someone and be like, hi, I want to like pay me to do this, and you're just like, wait, like who are you, right? So thinking about that, the communication styles, and not really being afraid to just start those connections early, because it might not just be like a right away like, hey, I'm gonna get booked for a deal, but really starting to build that relationship with people even through the internet, right? Like messaging people, adding people on Twitter, and really getting to like understand what their needs are. But also I think not being afraid to like ask your network, like, hey, do you know of any opportunities doing this, this, and that? And as well as establishing your online presence, I think even just starting with a website with even like, hey, this is what I focus on, this is what I can do, is really simple, because you can start just sending that link around once you start connecting to people online. So I hope that helps a bit.
yeah, that is great. That is great. One last thing, one last question. As far as getting paid for work, what do you particularly use, especially for freelance jobs, to get paid, to ensure that you're not getting stiff? What is that process? Are you requiring a deposit, or is it honor code on the payment on the back end? How are you ensuring that there's no breakdown?
I've tried all of those and have been gotten stiff. So, and even though like I read and I took advantage, like I took in my friend's recommendations and stuff, I think what's worked best is definitely a deposit. Asking for that upfront. The other thing is, if you're going to freelance with like a more established companies, offering discounts in the sense.
Oh,
yeah. Oh, okay. I'll just finish up this one.
I clicked on the button to stop your screen share because I realized we were still screen sharing.
So the last thing is really trying to think, one, getting a deposit, and then that is might be the best thing. You can also offer a discount if paid in full, which would be like if you require $5,000, then being like, yeah, you get a 10% discount, but pricing it at like, you know, $5,500, and be like, you get 10% off if paid in full. A lot of companies as well might have a policy that they have to take an offer at a discount. So that's something I have, like little tricks that I've learned, you know, and also instituting a late policy, right? If they cannot pay you on time, being like, okay, cool, you get an additional charge after this, because especially if you're working with startups, it gets really messy on their payroll. And if you're working with more established companies, they might have that policy that they have to take you up on your discount and can pay you up front.
Great, great. Those are some great things there that every freelancer should understand, which is basically getting paid. I've seen so many times, so many areas where people, they would do work, and they get stiffed and they're complaining about it. And that's one of the things that it's hard. It's hard to understand that, you know, there's a process to getting paid sometimes. And it's incumbent on you to provide the correct tools to collect payment. Right. And then having the right policies in place, procedures in place to make sure that, you know, you can get paid on time and not get stiffed, protecting yourself as a freelancer.
And itemizing your invoices, even if you're offering like special add-ons, just so people recognize like the value of your work, taxes, and like any fees that might be collected. If you're using even like PayPal, they'll take like a 2% fee. I think it's 3%. So calculating all of that. Oh, Ingrid is dropping gems. I'm seeing her like comment on these.
She said, look, I invoice before I start 30% up front, 30% halfway through, and 40% for people who receive the final product.
That is awesome.
That is awesome.
Well, thank you so much. And everyone can connect with me on LinkedIn, on Twitter. I'm on the internet. I live here.
Yeah. Just drop your Twitter handle real quickly.
Okay, cool. All right. Well, thank you so much.
You're welcome. You're welcome. So up next here, we're going to have Kirby. She's going to be coming on here shortly with Kirby. If you hear me, come on into the queue, come back into the green room. We're going to have her next. She's going to be talking about remote culture when your values don't align with your company's values. So this, you know, the first half of the conference, we all focused on remote workers. There's going to be nuggets around freelancing as well. Up after that is going to be, oh, you jumped in. Okay. up next after that is going to be Kimberliann Chambers after our break, talking about taxes and pivoting your business and so forth. All right, if we can, hi, Eb. Eb, you're on live here. This is Eb, of course, if you're in the Slack channels. She's over the community, basically.
Hey,
in the Slack channel.
Can you hear me? Because I can't hear you on one of my tabs.
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay. I have two different screens going. Hello.
So, Eb is over our community. She is very influential and implemental in getting information out there, getting our groups together and so forth, making sure that the community. So if you want to introduce yourself really quickly, Eb, while I get Kirby on. Oh, can you hear me, Eb?
Sure, I'm Eb. As Jabril has said, I am the community liaison for inclusion. You see a whole lot of stuff of what I'm putting out there. I think I can. Can you hear me? Hold on. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
I can't hear you, which is weird. Hold on.
Oh, the Teddy Riley curse is going on right now. So we're getting this straightened out here. Eb, I can hear you just fine. Okay, we have Kirby on now.
Hi.
Hello, hello, hello. How are you?
I'm good. I have a presentation too. How do I get that in here?
Good, good. Okay, you can share your screen. There's a little monitor at the bottom, a monitor icon that allows you to share your screen.
Okay, at the bottom. Here we go. Gotcha, screen record. Okay.
All right. I thought the Teddy Riley curse was going to affect us here.
No, what happened was, yeah, I had two screens going, so I had, because I'm moderating in one and looking at the other, so that's what was confusing. Going on. Hey, Kirby, how are you?
I am well, and yourself?
I am doing great. I would be the first to say that I need to come to you to start learning how to do head wraps, because I'm like, I actually did my hair for today. You can ask your bro. And a lot of other people who know me, because I've just been like, I'm not doing it today. But for you, I did my hair today.
This is how I do my hair all the time, mainly because, and you'll have to forgive me, I'm having the most geriatric moment in my life right now.
That's fine.
I wear my hair in wraps because I sew them myself, and then also because I have free locks. So, okay, great. I think that's up there and where I needed to be. Cool.
Yes, yes. So
it makes me feel comfortable.
I'm excited for your discussion because you are talking about something that is near and dear to my heart, which is personal values.
Yeah.
And also, you know, who you work for the company. And I'm going to tell everybody right now, it's your clients. I'm like very good at that. So just tell us a little bit about yourself. I will eventually drop off, but I just wanted to make the introduction. Everyone, this is Kirby. She has a lot of stuff going on. She does have a freebie out there. So please, please, please join the Flexcon 2020 channel so you can get access to everybody's freebies and continue to network over there as well. So Kirby, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Okay, thank you so much. I appreciate you. First of all, I want to thank you all, Jabril, of course, for creating the platform, and then for you all giving us the platform today. I know this is going to be a monthly series, so hopefully I'll figure out something even more interesting to talk about over time. A little bit of background, so I'll follow suit in how things have been going thus far. I've been in customer success and customer experience, since 2011. Clients like Microsoft Xbox, Chick-fil-A, all over the place. A lot of startups recently, and I definitely want to echo some of the sentiments about startups and their messiness sometimes, and I'm glad that we're in a safe space because I'm going to speak very candidly. And I appreciate she also mentioned about, you know, being able to fire your clients. That's really important. But I wanted to, and some other background about me. Information systems major. I love tech. Right now, I'm enjoying some time at one of you all's favorite retail organizations while looking for some other freelance opportunities. So drop your ideas down in there. But I also worked for an HR company, an HR software, a SaaS company at some point, and that's what got me interested in values of a company and how that can impact how a company can run. And then in context of this conversation, how you have to take your personal values and professional values and make them a part of the process of choosing clients or choosing companies to work with, whether you're a freelancer or you're still salaried, corporate, et cetera. So remote. With your company. So let me hop over here. Let's go to the next slide. So how do your values impact your work? So I would hope that everyone here has had an opportunity to sit down and really think about processes and values and how you want to be able to do your work, who you want to work with, and what your limits and boundaries are as far as that's concerned. Part of my values is efficiency. I like it when people have things done in a way that's easy to follow. I'm an adult learner because I'm over the age of 30. So a bunch of reading is not always necessarily the best way for me to digest information. Make sure that, you know, the projects that you're bringing forward, you're very clear on your vision. I like that. That's something that I appreciate. But thinking about how you like to work, who you like to work with, what is important to you to get out of your work. That could be something as simple as, I don't want to work with certain types of organizations that affect the environment negatively. That could be something in your value system. You could say that you, like I said, you want to work with companies that are efficient or data driven or marketing heavy, whatever those things are. So sitting down and thinking about those things are very important, especially in a freelance and remote economy. I just went through a situation where it was quite clear that the organization hired a really great agency to build their value package and their value offer, but the actual day-to-day operations was out of sync. And we'll talk about that a little bit more later. So like I said, what are your values? Do you prefer working for tech positive companies? There are some companies out here that have very small tech stacks that you work with on your individual teams or projects, et cetera, depending upon whether you're a UI designer or a software developer or photographer, you know, because I also do some creative things as well. So depending upon, you know, who you're working with, you need to be identifying some of those things as well. Make a list and make sure that you try to stick to that list. You're not always going to align all the time, but it's much easier to figure out what clients you want to work with, what type of environments and type of deadlines that you want to be under, and the type of value that you add to your projects. Picking companies and clients. This has been an interesting journey for me because, like I was just saying, people, organizations, large companies will, it's very easy for people to create a branding situation and say that their values are accountability or consistency, accuracy, speed, or whatever it is. And then you get in and you've gotten through an interview process, totally different situation. So it's important to take some time to do some research on your clients. And if you can, you know, use some of the public areas that are available to do that. You have Glassdoor, you have networking, you can check what type of philanthropic endeavors that they participate in as an organization. So of course, like large organizations may be, they may have like a diversity and inclusion department or like group that they utilize within that company so that you can kind of get like an idea of how they work. Glassdoor is very helpful. We all have probably had some interesting run-ins with Glassdoor and some of the reviews that you will find on there, but they actually are helpful. And if you take the time to do a little bit of data analysis, read through a few of them, you can get an idea on whether or not a company is actually aligned with the values that they have been marketing essentially through their job descriptions. And then just their business connections. Who do they do business with? Who have they done business with previously? If you have a client that gets handed off to you and you know anyone who's ever worked with them before, you know, don't feel like you can't, you know, do a little quick interview like, hey, how was working with this particular client? Were they responsive to emails? Were they responsive to requests for et cetera? Were they responsive to invoices, et cetera? That is really, really important as well. Alignment in general. So like the process for me is to test people out. Especially during the interview process, ask the hard questions. So ask, of course, questions that are relevant to your values. One thing that I always ask is, tell me about a time when, and I'll pick one of the values that they are touting, has shown up to be consistent in your company culture. And a lot of times, I'm not gonna lie to you all, people get stuck on those types of questions because they're most of us are trained to kind of deal with the standard interview questions. But when I'm asking about something that is about the heartbeat and at the soul of your company, if you can't give me an answer, that kind of gives me an indication or the, you know, haphazardly put together. And of course, like I said, don't be afraid to challenge your value. So like I said, for example, you see that a project has been done with a company and they didn't include any insight from anyone that particular project is going to affect. So like, for example, if you're working for a nonprofit and they're going into communities and I don't know, doing some type of project that could potentially end in some type of gentrification, if they don't have an answer for how they're going about the work that they're doing, that's definitely a deep indicator for me that, you know, we may need to, you know, reconsider this. And don't be afraid to adjust. And I think about this a lot. How can I challenge and stay balanced and employed? Set the groundwork, be yourself. Always be clear about what your values are when you're going into a situation with your clients and with new companies. Be clear from the beginning. Don't be afraid to be a culture shifting force. If you see something that you know is not going to either align with you or does not make sense, don't be afraid to speak up about it. And of course, know your worth. Just reiterating and echoing what the young lady was saying earlier, knowing what your time is worth is also very deeply rooted in the values that you have for yourself. And make sure that you have options. Don't ever get super attached to something to the point where, oh gosh, this is going to crush my world if I don't get this particular project. Make sure that things are rooted in who you are, who you want to be professionally and personally, and that's going to move you forward in whatever efforts and endeavors that you have. That's kind of the end of my presentation. I know I ran through a lot of that stuff. I am on social media. Where is Kirby Ann? I haven't been, I'm sorry. I had to run through that because I have to concentrate when I do stuff. I'm one of those like butterfly kids. So I haven't looked through that yet. But any questions that y'all have, give me just a second. And Evie, go ahead, do your moderation thing. Let me know what you want to talk about.
No, and that's fine. So you did bring up some great points. And if someone doesn't know their core values, how would you suggest that they identify those?
I would reflect on how you live your life. You know, one of the ways in which I'm constantly, and values change. Let me say right. that. What is it that you want to accomplish in your life? For example, for me, I value my time greatly, which is why I like to work remote. Mm-hmm. So I know that is something that is core for me. I want to be able to really, really have a lot of control over my time. So sit back and reflect on what makes you feel comfortable. Think about the working situations that you've been in. I think about all the companies that I've worked for, corporate and contract related, and said, what were the experiences that I enjoyed? whose documentation was really, really great, whose culture as far as how they communicate and how they work together, and sit down and really, really think about that in relation to what you're trying to accomplish in your own personal and professional life. And that will help you to list off the things I think that are important to you.
Right, right. Do you ever feel there is a time that someone should compromise their values? And let me give you an example. I am very, very big on, you know, having a core three, core five. And sometimes the person that you may be working with in a business relationship or a company, they may match up to maybe four, but that fifth one is like, you know, it's not so there. So how do you feel about that?
I think that all of that is situational. A lot of the studies that I've been reading as it relates to like cultural alignment in general within organizations as individuals has talked about that a lot, about the fact that there are going to be times when you're going to have to make adjustments. And I think, like I said, it's situational, and you're going to have to kind of pick and choose. A, is this a situation where you're compromising a value to a point where you're not going to be able to live with yourself? I would hope that right. You're not dealing with clients in the first place that would put you in that position. But if you're finding yourself there, if it's something that is that you're not going to be able to sleep at night, or that is not going to push you in the direction that you know you need to be going professionally and personally, mm-hmm. I think it's worth, you know, taking a step back and saying no on certain situations, which I'll go back to the you got to have options. Once right. You get really ingratiated, make sure that you have maybe one or two, maybe three projects going on, so that if you need to let somebody go because they don't know how to act, you can. I don't think that there's anything wrong with that. And I know that can be really, really scary for people, but if you don't set any boundaries, you're going to do anything for anybody. And right. To the young lady's point previously, you'll be working all kind of crazy hours. And like I said, I value my time. I'm only giving 10 hours out of my day at any given time to anything outside of myself and my personal projects and my other entrepreneurial endeavors. So you just got to make it right. Work for yourself.
Okay. So for those that are freelancers transferring over to, because I look at the four quadrants, you're an employee, self-employed, and everything else. And for those that don't know about the four quadrants, I'll post that over in the community. But those that are transitioning to business owners that now have to hire teams, what is your suggestions to make? Because I firmly believe that whoever is helping you run your company obviously has to have some type of the same values. It may not be from a religious, you know, perspective or, you know, that real personal stuff, but the core values, again, how do you encourage those that need the help because they can no longer be solopreneurs and they're like, okay, I need a team, but I just can't have anybody. What is your advice for them?
Again, be upfront, be clear with people. Don't be afraid to fire somebody. I mean,
right.
There's, yeah. And it's hard because of, like we're talking about being introverted, being very nice people, being very kind people, but part of the, and I'm not going to say that it's necessarily a curse, part of the gift of being a solopreneur is that you get the control.
Yeah.
So you have to take pride in that control. And in, like I said, in the process of hiring people, just be very clear and be very honest with them and say, hey, listen, these are the things that, you know, I can and cannot work with. I understand if it's, you know, if that's not going to work for you. But just be very clear with them. And then also, it's nothing wrong with asking people for references. Let me get some character witnesses.
Right.
If it's that serious, especially if, like, you know, I have people that work in government contracting, and that can get very serious sometimes, like to the point of, like, you know, fingerprinting and FBI background checks and stuff. You've got to be able to trust people. So don't be afraid of finding your ways of weeding people out. Questionnaires are really, really great. Ask people to. I know people don't like writing, but I would ask them, okay, tell me in writing about yourself or a really great project that you did.
Right.
How you went about it.
Right.
All the ways that you feel comfortable with pushing the issue. It depends on the project, though. That's definitely situational. But yeah, don't feel free to be honest. I think that's probably the most important key.
Okay. And lastly, because, of course, you know that we're dealing in a time of uncertainty. And, you know, we can definitely say that we really don't want to jump into a situation that is, you know, totally against our values. But when we have the individuals out there that may have lost clients or lost their job, and they're kind of up against some sketchy situations and have to have that income coming in, how do you think they should deal with that? Because it's kind of like, You know what I mean? You're still compromising, but you have to make sure that ends meet so nothing else is blowing up in your life.
For sure. Gosh, that can be a really, really hard one. And especially if you have kids. Right. I don't have kids yet, so I can be a little bit more. But
you have some flexibility.
I have a little bit more flexibility. Right. Again, that's just one of those internal introspective reflective moments that you're going to have to take. And nobody is going to judge you if you're trying to take care of your family. But again, if you can't sleep at night with it, I mean, all money is not good money. So I still have to defer to, like, you know, do the best that you can, do what you got to do, but definitely reach out to your network. When you find that you are the clients that you're finding on your own, or the people that you're working with are just not up to par, reach out to your network, reach out to your support system. Your support system, you built it to be similar to who you are in character anyway. So I would say that's probably my best advice. Reach out to your support system. Find out if they have people that they're working with that can, you know, kind of point you in the right direction. But I try your best not to compromise when you can. But again, I'm also not going to stop nobody from paying a mortgage. So
Right.
Yeah.
So to segue into Kirby of what she just said, if you guys are really, really wanting to connect with us, just join us on the inclusion, you know, community. We do have a online community. We have so many channels going on right now for graphic designers, whatever you have going on. Also go to inclusion.co. That's where you can upload your resume. And, you know, we have a lot of business opportunities coming up. Hence the reason why we wanted to kick off FlexCon, because we know that this is a needed resource. So Kirby, just tell people where they can reach you. I see that you have a slide, and just let us know where we can just ask you questions or connect.
You can connect with me with all the items listed, LinkedIn for all the super professional stuff. So like customer success, customer experience, training, instructional design, etc., IT related things. For all of my creative endeavors, you can hit me up on Where is Kirby Ann. I actually just started with that.
You started a catering company?
Mm-hmm. It's called what now?
You kind of cut out. You said you started a catering company?
Yeah. It's called Have One More Bite. Hold on a second. Can I type it on here? I can't. It's called Have One More Bite. It's spelled with normal words. It's nothing crazy. But it's just in response to this situation, you know, meal planning and prep. But I also, I'm brunch focused. So if we're able to go outside in June, I'm having a brunch at Amano ATL, and I'm thinking about debuting like a plantain stuffed French toast. So if any of you all are interested, let me know.
I will be.
Yeah, definitely having fun, having some fun over there. But, like, you know, freelancing is not just always tech related, although I know there's some tech I'm going to incorporate into the catering, but it's something that I do well and I have fun with. So. Okay. But if y'all have any types of questions, and I say that, like, I'm in tech and stuff like that, but I'm one of those dibbler dabblers type of people. I literally know a little bit about everything, or I can point people in certain directions. My friend Nicole always tells me that I really need to make my title a connector, because I know, like, way too many different types of people that do too many different types of things, and I do too much. Like I said, I've got to go sew some pants in a minute. I've got some cakes that I've got to bake, all kinds of stuff going on, so.
That's pretty cool. So have you done the Strengths Finders assessment as of yet?
The Stress Finders?
Strengths Finder.
No, I've done like HBDI. And, okay.
So I'm going to put some resources in there, because you said a keyword connector, and that is one of the top 34 strengths, where people are, they come to you or they gravitate towards you because you have so much information and you're like, oh, go do this and I'll go do that. And it's way like, too much. Right. And I'm guilty of that too, but you did say something else too that I really wanted to tap into before we bring DJ Knots back in, that it is okay to find multiple streams of income. And that is the best thing as a freelancer or a small business owner. Exactly. Don't even ask me right now, because I'm like, I lost count. But if you have been kind of sketchy or had questions, not sketchy, I don't want to use that word because it's kind of negative. If you had questions on how do you balance your life and become the entrepreneur, and, you know, preneur, if you break that word down, preneur means to take, the taker. So everybody that's on this line, you have every right to take what's rightfully yours. I would definitely encourage you guys to tap into multiple streams of income. If you have a passion to cook, like, you know, Kirby, and she's about to go sew, and I'm about to hit her up, be like, what are you sewing? You know, are you selling something that I can help you out with? And it's also a way of connecting and supporting each other's business. So I'd like to throw that out there. Kirby, thank you, thank you, thank you.
Thank you.
Definitely will be reaching out to you. DJ Knots, are you ready? Because we're about to
wrap you up.
Everyone, as we're transitioning, you can hop back into the networking events, you can chat, you can do a whole lot of other stuff. And again, we'll start putting out there everybody's information, like Kirby's and Joy's, and you can just really connect with them there. And I see DJ Knox, so I'm going to get off so he can take it over. Have a good one.
Appreciate it.
So Notch, you have had some requests. I'll have to go back to the chat, but everybody clap, clap, clap for the DJ, clap for the DJ.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Let me get out of here. I'll check out the chat too.
And all keep right, going that'll work.
Appreciate it.
Kimmy.
Hi.
How are you, love?
I am doing good. I am doing good. So I'm just...
Please excuse the excitement on my behalf because I have been trying to get him on the line for the longest. I have known her for over 3 years now. She's owner, creator of DAC Tax Act, also has a co-chair working space out of Brooklyn, New York. So anybody from Brooklyn, anybody from New York, let me see you represent in the chat. And Kim is coming to you from a great place because she is a tax guru. She is a money, I just call her the money person, like for real. And she also is teaching people how to pivot. So I am going to leave it to you and we'll go from there.
All right. All right. Thank you, Ev. Yes, we've known each other 3 years now. That's crazy. So let's talk about pivoting. I just had, you know, technical difficulties and had to pivot and figure it out. So that's what my topic today is. So I want to give you a little introduction on myself. Eb introduced me, but I am a virtual tax and accounting professional. So my company is about 4 years old, started in 2015 as my side hustle. I've been doing taxes much longer. I'm a daughter of an IRS agent. So I have been around taxes for a very long time. Let's put it like that. I think I started data entry in taxes at 13. So I know a bit about taxes, I must say. So with that being said, you know, starting my job, I started, as I mentioned, as a side hustle. And I kind of went through the gamut of challenges. I knew I wanted a virtual business. I wanted to be on a virtual premise, but you know, I just was very slow in bringing it to that. I actually grew since opening, and I expanded to two offices. I had an office in Queens and Bronx. I was also servicing people nationwide virtually. But if like anyone else, I've been affected by COVID-19. I'm sure everyone here has. So we are all now at home, full-time at home professionals. So how I was affected, as I said, I service nationwide virtually, but I wasn't exactly ready to be 100% virtual. I had the two locations. I had to close those locations down and really operate in the space of going fully, completely virtual and not exactly being ready for it. So with that being said, like many of you, I'm sure you guys are affected by COVID-19, whether you're home working for a business remotely, or you had to transition and do something else because, you know, you were let go from your job due to COVID-19. So we're going to talk about pivoting there. So COVID-19, you know, we look at it as a bad thing, but it has given us an opportunity. You know, I just want to give you guys a statistic. The average US driver spends 97 hours stuck behind other cars in 2018. So, you know, just think about that. You know, now we don't have that. So what do we do? What's the best way to optimize that time? You know, you may be working or you may be looking to gain work virtually. So, you know, I'm just here to show you how to take advantage of this opportunity that we are in being virtual right now. So I wanted to talk about the first aspect of that. I know we're limited on time and I want to have space for questions as well. I'm going to go through. The first thing I would urge everyone to do is, you know, gain further knowledge. Find your passion. You know, either you already have an inkling of what you want to do. You always wanted to do something. I would tell you to definitely self-assess yourself and identify what's your interest versus what you have aptitude in. Your interest is your passion. You know, you may have always wanted to do, like me, taxes. That's a lie. I didn't always want to do taxes. I think I did it for so long as a child. I ran for it for a long time, and I jumped into it a couple of years ago, and I found a love for it again. So you either have a passion for something or you're just good, naturally good at something. You know, this is the opportune time to explore that and take advantage of that. Another thing you can do is take classes. There's a lot of free courses out there. Personally, there is a Cornell. I got accepted to Cornell for a free online business course. They're offering those right now. I think I saw one for Harvard where they're teaching coding. There's a lot of opportunity out there that you can increase a skill or learn a new skill. If you already have the skill, there's a lot of free opportunities just to find them and take advantage of them. Also, you can also join social networking groups that are of your interest. So like, for example, I'm going to use me as the example. There are tax groups. So there's also niche tax groups. I have a niche also in cannabis tax and accounting. So I help legal cannabis businesses, you know, with their finances. So I have joined tax networking groups that deal with that. And I've learned from people that have been in this industry for a while. So I urge you to also do that. If you are interested in real estate, in anything that you can pivot into at this time, find that social networking group online and become a part of it and become an active member in there. Also, one thing for me is very important. Anytime I have a question or I have an interest or I want to learn something, I have never been afraid to ask and always put myself in a position of learning. So if there's a person that's a subject matter expert in something that I have just an interest in or a question on, I am not afraid to jump in their inbox or DM and, you know, just kind of ask questions and just be open to what they tell me. It's not always, you know, the best thing. You're not going to always get friendly and open people to be teach, you know, that's willing to teach you, or teachers, I should say. But it doesn't hurt to ask. That's one thing I would encourage everyone to do. Another thing that you can do, don't be afraid to start, you know, start now. You don't have to wait for your business, you know, or I'm sorry, for your knowledge to be up to par, or your skills to be up to par. You can start your business. You can lay the groundwork for your business now. So with that being said, you know, evaluate what business or what skill you have that fills a need out there, especially in this virtual time. I know a lot of you, if you are changing careers, say you were in a customer facing position where, you know, your business really depends on dealing with a client. I know I've talked to event planners that atypically deal with, you know, big events that are face to face and different situations like that. And I have coached them to, why don't you start doing event planning online? There's things you can do where you do a social, like we're on this platform right now, you do a social event. You can plan that out. You can do a networking event between business females and do like a spa day online. There's different avenues that you can pivot into, even though you see yourself as, you may see yourself as stuck, but there are avenues that you can explore in order to, you know, take the best advantage of this time. So with that being said, you can also determine what type of brand you want. The brand, building your brand, you wanna create something very memorable, not just the logo, you know, your Facebook page, you wanna make sure it's something appealing to everybody else. So in determining your brand, like I said, you wanna ensure that you're defining your value and telling a story, and people will enjoy interacting with you. You wanna build relationships, and that's what's important. So again, with all of that, don't be afraid to experiment. In this day and time, we don't know what will be a success for us, or what may be your first thought process to jump into. You know, don't be afraid to fail. You fail forward. You know, you experiment and you keep going. We're going to come out of this with different skills, you know, a different mindset. You may not, what you went into this time being, you may end up being something else. So definitely don't be afraid to experiment. And don't be afraid that your first thought was not a success. Don't fear that. You learn from failure and your mistakes, definitely. And at the end of it, I do want to talk about making whatever you decide to do legal. We often start as side hustles, to be honest. Sometimes you're not ready for it, but I can not implore more the tax advantages. And this is the only piece I'm going to mention, tax. I really wanted to talk about, you know, pivoting and not being stuck right now and not having, you know, the fear of displacement. Even though we're virtual and the world is different and we're going to be a different world after this, I really wanted to talk to that. But my tax mention in this is that make it legal when the time is right. Definitely start your business, register your business, you know, make that transition from a hustle to definitely something of permanence. And when you're ready for that, you'll know it moves from passion to being a viable business for you. So definitely just don't fear the time and don't feel stuck. I just want you to know that we're all in this together and we'll definitely be a success and move forward.
So going back to, because I know that you were just touching on taxes for a minute, but we do have some questions or some thoughts on how do you, so I can point it to you one or two ways. I see that there are freelancers out there that are kind of stuck in the middle of, do I file for certain things? Do I not? Do I even qualify for it? And I know that we were talking about pivoting, which is great, but can we address, you know, the smaller congregation, so to speak, of what is your advice for those freelancers that may need more information? Or we may have some people on here that may not have even filed an EIN or have filed their taxes as of yet personally. So how do you think that they should address that?
Okay. So at this time, as you know, or as you may not know, taxes has been extended till July 15th. So you have time. So you can file for your EIN tomorrow. You can really register your business, but if you're regarding the course of last year, it may be a bit late, but it does not take away from the fact that you can be a sole proprietor. So with a sole proprietor, you can file under your Social Security, and that's on a Schedule C. So that's a business return for an individual. So for a freelancer, for an independent contractor, that type of thing. So it's you can handle it. You can still file your taxes appropriately.
Okay. So if there is any questions that anyone would have on the conference line or sooner to watch this at a later time, where do you suggest that they go for answers? Because sometimes, you know, as you know, Facebook may not be it, Instagram may not be it. And the news, a lot of people are getting frustrated because then, you know, one state may say this, another state may say that. Of course, everybody lives in different states, different countries and everything else. So where is the central location where people should go for information like this?
So for information on your registration on how you file your taxes is usually your state website. So like I'm New York State, I would visit the New York State website in order to, they have a specific site for corporations and also IRS. So first and foremost, if you're interested in starting your EIN, let me back up. If you are interested in becoming an official separate entity, you would file that with IRS.gov. You will register and get your EIN number. Then at a later time, you can always operate as a business under that EIN. And at a later time, you can register that with the state. You can also register first, or you could do it in the converse. You could register first with the state and then get your EIN as well. So, you know, the optimal place to research that would be the state website, your specific state website. And another thing, another source that I always recommend people that they don't often think about, there's websites like score.org. They're for entrepreneurs and businesses, as well as the SBA, what, you know, everybody, SBA should be a buzzword right now.
Right.
They have a lot of resources for people that are small businesses or want to start small businesses, as well as your Chamber of Commerce. You could look at US Chamber of Commerce. That's like the centralized one for all of them across the nation. The US Chamber of Commerce is also a good source.
Okay. So Brian has a great question. He wants to know, at what point would you recommend freelancers restructure from sole proprietors to S-corps?
Okay, so a S-corp. You could be a sole proprietor and start off as an LLC. You're still operating as a separate entity. You have some protections like corporations, but if you want to take it one step further and go transition into an S-corp, I would say when you are making at least $40,000 to $50,000, and the reason I say that, when you are bringing in income that's roughly $40,000 to $50,000, there's certain requirements of the S-corp that may be lacking in benefit for just a small growing business. Mm-hmm. One, there's fees associated with it. There's a requirement for the S-corp that you have to maintain payroll as a individual in the S-corp, where you would not have that as a sole proprietor. So to transition to that, it's not a bad thing, but just you got to weigh the cost associated with it, because you get added costs on a yearly basis when associated with a S corp, as well as managing your payroll. You have to put yourself on payroll.
Okay. So really quick, pivoting back to what you, and not using that word as a pun intended, because we should have had a key word, you know, for the day. And
yes, yes.
So because of the fact, speak to the people that have all of these ideas, because you and I both know that you and I can just like crank out 85 ideas at once. And it's like, how do we just be like, you know, pivot, especially to those that are brick and mortar? Like, you had a brick and mortar and you literally had to pivot. And there's a lot of other organizations or business types represented here. So speak to those of how do they hone in on that one idea, mm-hmm. and then making sure they're lining that up financially. Of what do they need to consider that once they get that idea of following the process from IRS? And, you know, and I know that you have to go through the EIN process and all the other stuff, but speak to them of honing on one idea. And, you know, like you didn't go into cannabis right off the bat. No. That was, you know, 3 years later or whatever. Mm-hmm. So at the end of the day, just touch on that if you can.
Okay. So once you discover what you can pivot into, you know, so for me, it was an easy transition. That was always in the back of my head. Virtual was always in the back of my head. And I was making baby steps to transition to that. So I can speak to it because I'm walking that walk right now. I had to immediately jump into it. So once you find that idea, whatever you were, I believe either you're going to seek passion or you're going to seek aptitude, what you're good at. So you're going to, once you find that idea and you hone in on that idea and you find it's something viable that you can make it work, you test it out. You test it in you know, in social environments. You see if it will work. And then if you see if it will work, once it starts taking hold, like a lot of people I know that, like, for example, I have a friend that's a hairdresser. And, you know, of course, that's a front-facing, a customer-facing type of job of industry. So she has to pivot what she's doing now. She's selling right. products online. She's giving consultation virtually through Zoom to assess what your problems are so she can recommend the best products for you. You know, there are ways to do it. She's about to do a training course to do to show home how to take care of your hair at home. So once you find your idea, don't be afraid to try it out. And sometimes it may not work. It might need tweaking. And that's the experimental stage. And I don't want people to give up in that experimental stage that you are trying to figure out whether this is a win for you or not. You know, so once you do it, just experiment and keep going.
Okay. So wrapping everything up, how can, I know that you definitely, because you and I had a late conversation last night of what you're offering to freelancers, business owners, of not just from the tax arena, because mm-hmm. you would always start with taxes, and definitely you and I had conversations about profit first and, you know, mm-hmm. a whole lot of other stuff, which I'm excited about. So tell everyone how they can contact you, let everyone know what you're offering. We will be putting your offer in the Flexcon channel on Slack. And also definitely everyone that has asked about other additional resources, I will definitely be getting those from Kim so we can get those up in the tools, because she has an extensive list. She is very, very knowledgeable. Within the 15 minutes that we gave her, it does not just does justice. So thank you for being patient with us with everything for that. So tell everyone what you're offering, where we can reach you, and all that other fun stuff.
Okay. So definitely I do strategy sessions, no matter the industry you're in. Usually, and what Eb is referring to, we're both good at it, but I have a skill where if you tell me what you're doing, you know, I can come up with 5, 7, 10 different things you can explore. So that's where I'm telling you, it's important to pivot and be open to pivoting and don't feel stuck. So I have those strategy sessions that I do offer, and you can find out about them or contact me at my website, www.dactaxact.com, and that's dactaxact.com. You can also, my business number is 1-888-611-1040. You can give a call to set an appointment for those type of strategy sessions. It's a free 15-minute conversation to go over what's going on, where do you feel stuck, where do you have an idea to go. And I kind of explore or take the walk with you, the journey with you, to see where you can expand to and where you can really lay some foundation.
Okay. So lastly, what are you looking forward to with the cannabis piece? Because I know that we really can't get into that now, but when we talk about multiple streams of income, we like encourage multiple streams of income. Yes. So I know Kim can't get into a whole lot of that right now. Don't know if a lot of you are interested in that, but at the end of the day, it's one of those things of, why did you even want to get into that? And if someone is interested, how do you do that?
Okay, so when I restarted my tax and accounting practice, I knew off the bat that I wanted to be mobile, virtual. I wanted to have a specialization. So that's how cannabis came about. I missed the whole crypto. Crypto kind of gives me a headache, cryptocurrency. But cannabis was an emerging industry where it's going through prohibition right now. It's on the cusp of being legal. You know, one half of the country, it's legal. In some states, it's legal, but it's federally illegal. So the complexities of managing that and trying to be visionary and jump in a business like that, that's where I want to support minorities, women, you know, anybody that, any small business owner that's daring enough to say, this is a space I want to operate in. You know, I want to support them and make sure, you know, financially, you know, or they keep out of hot water with IRS, to be honest. You know, they're structured properly, they're profitable, that type of thing. So that's where I kind of have a passion for it. You know, not only, you know, I believe in the medical, you know, benefits of it. I also feel that, you know, it's time to make it legal and all the things. I don't even want to get into the political aspects of it.
Right,
but,
right. We don't do a lot of politics on these type of calls.
Yes. So definitely if anyone's interested, that's my area of expertise as well, starting legal cannabis businesses and getting you set up financially. You know, there are challenges because it's still federally illegal, and hopefully within a year or two, we can change that. But, you know, there are some challenges, and it's good to be aware of that. So I do consult for that as well.
Okay. So you guys, there you have it. Kimberliann is a multifaceted entrepreneur. And of course, as I said, this 30-minute or 20-minute discussion has not done justice on, especially on taxes, because when I first met her, I was like, dude, you can have that. Like, what do I just send you? Because I'm not doing it right now. But definitely very creative. Again, you can reach her at dactaxact.com. Mm-hmm. All of her contact information on there. You can also schedule anything that you need to book her on her calendar. Also see a list of her services. Yeah. And of course, we will have her in the chat on the Flexcon community as well. So if you have any questions, feel free to reach her out there and go from there. And thank you again, Kimmy.
Thank you.
The first time.
Thank you.
Ready to call you.
I appreciate it.
And I am going to bring back Dribrill because we have some conversating to do.
All righty. That was a great conversation.
Yes. Yes. So what do you want to talk about?
Yeah. So everyone, I goofed up a little bit on the schedule. I don't know where this magical 30 minutes came from that I didn't.
Everything happens for a lot reason.
Of time in. Okay. So what I actually want to do, you you want to put me on the spot, but I want to put you on the spot, Eb. I want to ask you about your purpose, your business.
Oh, wow.
and talk about, yeah, because, you know, one of the things that we did when we, so just real quickly, we're going to talk for a few minutes, then we're going to bring the DJ back in real quick and then bring Chantel in after that. I had a lot of time. So, and that gives you a little bit more time, of course, network. There's 55 people online right now in the chat. So there's plenty of more people to meet with, especially through the networking tab. So we want you to continue to network as well. But I want to ask you, so when I was trying to put this together and trying to put this whole process of having a virtual conference together, it was always physical conference. Because of COVID, of course, and you stepped up and you are a business consultant and you work with small freelancers to agencies to businesses and getting them. So just give the audience a little background on what you do and how you got aligned into what we're doing with FlexCon.
So I am a divorcee of corporate America. I would have to put that out there. And, you know, even going through the ladder or growing the ladder in corporate America, there was just a lot of rules that I couldn't, you know, keep up with. And I'm always a rule breaker. For those who are on here that know me, they may be laughing, saying, yes, she is. Purpose has always been big with me. It, like, I don't want to sit in a meeting unless I know there's a purpose. Like, if we can just handle this through email, let's do that. So purpose, as you may eventually learn about me, is very high on my value list. I personally am the one to pull you out of your comfort zone to definitely, without a doubt, find out what your purpose is. And it's maybe not even a question of finding your purpose. It's really one of those things of, you know what your purpose is, now walk in it. There's a whole lot of stuff of what I say that we have in our frontal lobe blockage that kind of puts us in a place of, oh, I'm too scared to do this, or I don't have the resources or anything else. So to give you background of how I left corporate America 3 years ago, actually May 31st, or March 31st, I'm sorry. I was working for SunTrust. I can put that out there, very big here in Georgia, and was working them for 14, 15 years. I was a single parent, divorced. And I literally got tired of asking time to spend, you know, time with my kids or to really have the passion of what I wanted to do going forward. So because I'm very big on processes and procedures, they say, hey, we want you to evaluate these processes and procedures, because they were really trying to figure out what to do with me. I was along the footprint of traveling, training, and everything else, teammate engagement. So I throw everything on the wall, literally, with sticky notes, and I see where I came across each footprint. And I'm like, how do I remove myself from these footprints so I can say that they can totally get rid of me? Now, people are like, what the heck are you thinking? And I honestly did that. So presents to the powers that be, and they're looking at me like I'm crazy. They're like, are you sure? I said, yeah. So they was able to let me go. And then from there, I started out as a virtual assistant. Kimberliann was one of my, you know, clients. So that's how she and I met 3 years ago. And growing from there, it was, again, looking at, yes, I knew that I wanted to be a coach. Yes, I knew I wanted to be a full-fledged consultant. But what did I have in my hands right then and there? I had the experience of coming out of corporate America, and I know how to do everything from admin, website development, graphic design, XYZ. So that's how I started the virtual assistant piece. Then it was, okay, that's making money. Now let's go to the next level of another multiple stream of income. That's where I started more full-fledged of business consulting. Even though I did that while I was still working for corporate America, I still didn't have the freedom that I wanted to work with organizations like with Kimberliann, or even a whole lot of organizations, and talk about multiple streams of income. Your DJ is technically a life coach. A lot of people don't know that because they're jamming to his music right now, but he is a life coach and he has his own business, and I help him with that and everything else. So that's where it's been. He also has a great nonprofit organization called Hip Hop Gives Back. Kanata and I have known each other since 2008, and I was still working for corporate America then. So just pushing self from out of there. Fast forward to now, I've always saw the importance of becoming virtual. And I have always asked people, and whoever's on this line who know me can chime in, and y'all can say, yes, she does this. You can tell me your plan, and then I say, then what? Because to me, that one plan isn't just enough. you have to have your, and some people are like, well, why do I have to have a plan A, plan B? For times like this, like, if you're a business owner, you have to have your contingencies in place. You have to have your processes in place, your procedures. I would be one to say, if you don't have your processes and procedures in place, you're losing money somewhere. And not to throw anybody under the bus, but we have to get to that place of really running our business. Like, I have determined this year, I'm not running my business just to make ends meet. And I'm pretty sure a lot of people on here feel the same kind of way. You may be in a place of, I don't know what to do and I'm stuck. But if you can just repeat to yourself silently, I am not in business just to make ends meet, that'll clear the pathway for a whole lot of stuff to happen. So as a virtual assistant, I was able to dive into the online summit world. So this is how we were able to get FlexCon up and running literally in a week. Like, kid you not, we're having conversations and I'm like, so Jabril, when do you want to do this? I'm thinking he's like, you know, second week of May. He's like, nah, next Sunday. I'm like, what? And I'm glad we did it, because the response, the outcome has been so awesome. Like, I'm like, oh, wow. You know, he pushed me out of my comfort zone, because some people be like, I'm like, nah, we got to go through this. We got to go through this. And we got to go through this. It, at Real Talk, we had pieces all over the place to give you this. And that's what I love about this. Like, you've literally pushed me out of my comfort zone, because if not, I'm like, no, we got to go through step one and make sure we got all of that done, but we got it done. So I'm just like, yeah, but purpose is me. Purpose, intentions, purposepreneur. Purpose, intentions is the business consulting side. Purposepreneur is a business consulting side. Purpose, intentions is the purpose coaching side. And I push people's buttons. I push everybody out of comfort zone. You may not like me for 5 days, but we kumbaya, hug and come back. And that's where we're at. So I'm very glad that you and I have been able to connect for inclusion, because if anyone knows me, I'm all about engagement. We really want to make sure that whoever's a part of this community is getting what they need. And we may not be able to always do it right then and there, but just know that we're here for you. So I have to tip my hat off to you to having the courage to even starting something like this, because there's so many other people trying to duplicate the same thing, right. But you're not getting the same results. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, it's all.
Hopefully, that gave you the answer you needed. I know I gave you a mouth.
I appreciated that. I mean, it's all, and it's after this has been consistent. So we want to do one every month, because I was in the live networking. I connected with Ingrid, and Ingrid was saying that, hey, multiple touch points, and I agree with that. We need to have multiple touch points for our community where they can engage and have this particular type of programming. And so that's definitely something that's important there. And I'm a fast executor. It may not be polished all the way, but the execution is there, because you have to build off that initial attempt and to be able to build from there. Really quickly to ask you a question, because your concern is around development of a business. And this kind of point is from the previous conversation with Kim. One of my goals is, because I was a small business owner, then I owned then I launched a tech startup. But before being a small business owner, I was just hustling and bustling, right? What is your thoughts on being able to develop someone from a contractor or freelancer to having an LLC, right? What's the main thing that they need to understand when that transition of knowing when that transition needs to happen? Is it a certain amount of income? Is it a certain amount of clients? What do you to be that point where they say, okay, I'm not 1099 anymore. I'm filing an 1120 as an LLC.
Right. Honestly, I would literally say it depends on their determination and what they want their bigger picture to be like. If, like me, I didn't go freelancer. I just jumped right in on all of my businesses. So it really, again, it goes back to where they are. And in my coaching, I don't just deal with business. I deal with the frontal lobe. Like, what is keeping you here instead of letting you go up here? And of course, there's going to take some steps to go in between here and there. But what blockage do we have to remove to get you here? Because again, if you're looking at the four quadrants, yeah, we started out maybe at corporate America, or some maybe a 9 to 5, and then they're a entrepreneur. And when do you really get to the business owner piece? Me personally, the business owner piece is a mindset. The business owner piece is being intentional about what you put out there. I can care less if you know only how to do one thing. If you are confident in that one thing of you running a full-fledged LLC business, then I will support you in that in every and any kind of way. Because the freelancer piece, it puts you in a place of, yes, this is where you are. But if you have it in your gut, in your passion on whatever it is to go to the next level, do that. Even from a freelancer standpoint, don't take that lightly. If you have a freelancing business, make sure you have a domain. Make sure you have an email address. Like, I can tell you so many times how it bugs me where I see someone promoting their business, but then it's just like a Gmail address. It's like, dude, no, your mindset needs to be, everybody laughs, but it's all about mindset. Like, how do you want me to see you even as a freelancer to take you seriously when you come to me for business? And the same thing with finances. Kim may still be on here and she knows how I feel about this. The moment you decide to say that you're doing business transactions with someone, do not say you have Cash App. There are plenty of free resources that I'm going to end up putting out there where you can open up your free business accounts as a freelancer. There, Lily just came out, and Lily is just specifically for freelancers if you need a business account. So
that's an account accepting payment through Cash App, man.
So no, there's PayPal for that. And we can, whoever wants to have this conversation with me offline, because we only have so much time, I have no problem counseling you on this. But at the end of the day, and the reason why I say that is because the moment you decide to say that you want to transfer from freelancer to business, you cannot go back and say, oh, let me go look at my Cash App, payments, when really you had the tools in front of you all right then and there.
Right.
And if you start right, if you start with the right foundation, you're going to be able to build your building. Your freelance may be the foundation. You becoming an LLC may be the first, set of walls and the interior that you put in. But you can't put the walls in and the interior if your foundation is cracked. So again, it goes back to mindset. If you're a freelancer just to say that you're doing this for a hobby,
right,
and that you just want to be like, oh, I got something to promote on Instagram. No, do not tell me you got a website and then you send me to Instagram. We'll have that conversation all day. So if you are a freelancer, I am not beating you down, but I really want you to be the best. That is everything that you will always hear from me. Be your best and be better than the next person coming behind you, next to you, or in front of you, because you personally have something unique to offer. And I know I gave you a whole lot there, but are there any questions?
And that was a loaded question about the Cash App. The reason being is because of the fact that, and we've all used Cash App, first of all. The right. main thing is Cash App doesn't provide a dispute process, right? So if there's an issue with your money, or if there's an issue someone paying you or receiving a payment, first of all, and they don't provide an invoicing functionality either. So that's on both ends. When you think about protections for yourself, you're talking about protections for you, providing a layer of protection for you and the person who's paying you or the service that you're providing. And so I've seen so many horror stories where a person has paid a freelancer through Cash App and there's no remediation process for that payment. So of course you're the freelancer, so that isn't going to be as important because you're concerned with is getting your payment. Right. But there's two ends to that coin there. There's two sides to that coin in regards to getting paid and making sure that the person who's paying you is also comfortable also. So that's one of the reasons why I ask about Cash App, because I've seen that Cash App, they do have a business plan also. But even there, and there's the amount of protections that are available aren't there in the way that they would be with a PayPal, for instance. So someone said, I don't have Cash App. Building a banking relationship is key, and you cannot do that with Cash App. And that is
right.
True. Once and I again, find out,
you do have the resources out there.
Yeah. And I don't know why, but like here in Atlanta, Popeyes, they won't take Cash App anymore. So that tells you something there. It's like there's something going on with their card now, even on a personal level, as a personal user of Cash App. You have certain places now that aren't using Cash App to that extent. I think it's still a great tool. Like, for instance, if you sign up as a freelancer through Inclusion and you do a job and then your payment is due out of escrow, we will transfer you that money through Cash App, right? As a way to get paid. But generally, if you don't have some type of escrow in process in place, and you're doing business directly with that person who needs to utilize your skills, there are better ways, I should say, to collect your money and the invoice and things like that as well. So,
right. So Anita does have a question of what bank I mentioned. I did mention Lily. There's so many other things out there that just shoot me a direct message in Slack. Anybody that wants to have conversations, because I've been having conversations individually on the side with a whole lot of, you know, great people within the community. So again, I'm not beating anybody up, but I can tell you right now, dealing with me on this platform or even in Slack, I will do my best to push you to your greatness. And when it comes to finances, you can be the average Joe Blow of, you know, really offering one service, but I would really want you to feel as if you're that $1 million company offering a great service. And if you're that $1 million company in your mind, then you can do anything and everything and make sure that everything's done. Yes, Aslo, I push all my coaching clients to Aslo. If you have Aslo, they automatically send you a card. The one thing that I kind of liked about Lily is the fact that you can actually use Lily. They will send you a card as a debit card for a freelancer, but then they also help you keep track and itemize yourself for taxes. They also allow you to dump out your reports for taxes. The only thing with Lily, you will have to have a PayPal account to send out your invoices, to accept the money, and then have PayPal dump that money into Lily. So that's the only quirk that I saw with Lily. Aslo, you can actually connect to PayPal and Square. You can send out invoices with Aslo, but as long as you have Square and PayPal connected, you can accept payment via credit card. If not, then you would have to say transfer the money here and all this other stuff. So that's one thing that I do like about Aslo, because it is a free business bank account. They will ask you for your information up front if you have a copy of your Secretary of State papers. What is your EIN? If you file with, like, literally, if you sign up with Lily, they are going to say that you cannot sign up with an EIN as of yet. They're going to make you sign up with your Social Security number. So I know that we have some more to talk about. So definitely hit me up if I need to walk you through this. I mean, because I can do it in my sleep. So it's a 10-minute conversation of what needs to get done, depending on how you want to go. I would even challenge you to look at, if you have multiple streams of income coming in, how do you separate that? As a freelancer, do not commingle your finances that are coming in for business with your personal. I will definitely find a way to help you split that out too. So I don't see any more questions.
Yeah, there was one comment, and so I have Chantel Thompson. She's going to come up. Of course, she's supposed to be coming on at 5:30, but we're going to go ahead and bring her on early.
That's fine.
Rose, she made a couple comments in regards to that. You know, they don't use Cash App with their business.
Kirby got it. She dropped those links. Thank you, Kirby. Coretta, I see that you have tips on setting up accounts. Just we'll sideline this so we can keep it going, but definitely hit me up. You know, Ebb at Inclusion in Slack, so we can definitely have that conversation. Hi, Chantel.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Hey.
Good, good. Well, Chantel, thanks for coming on. You're a certified career coach, certified resume writer, LinkedIn profile creator. So this is, I expect this is going to be a great conversation, especially considering how many people are trying to make themselves look as presentable as possible because of the fact that so many people have lost jobs, have been furloughed in this pandemic that has been going on. So, you know, I look forward to a great conversation.
Great.
Do you want to start things off and just give a brief description about your qualifications and the expertise you come bring into this so we can get started with the topic?
Okay, great. Thanks, Jabril, and thanks, EB, for putting this all together. This has been, I've popped in and out a little, and it's been really informative and very helpful. My mission is to help people get out of the jobs of their nightmares into the careers of their dreams. I'm Chantel. I am with Sweet Job Spot. This is my Sweet Job Spot t-shirt, and I'm here to talk to you about branding. And I wanted to let you know that you don't have to have like a brand that is like a logo like what I have, right? So I'm here mostly to explain to you what the purpose of doing your personal branding is going to serve, whether you need a personal brand or not, and you know, the value of that brand. And I do have some slides. Well, this is very short and sweet. I did want it to be something that people could just take in and understand. So with personal branding, the thing that's really important is, you know, that's your reputation. It's who you are, it's what you've done. And it doesn't necessarily have to be, like I said, you don't have to have a logo. You don't have to have color scheme or anything like that. You just have to stay consistent with who you are. So so your personal brand, I want to talk about what is it, who needs it, and of course, how you can use it to attract clients, employers, and even business partners. And I'm sorry, I don't know what happened at the top of my screen. This should all say, what is personal branding, not what is LinkedIn, but I guess it didn't save, I don't know. So when you look for the definition of personal brand, and this is the first thing came up on Google, I Googled it, and it basically says it's a relationship with you, an individual who exists separately from your company, and the process of personal branding involves finding your uniqueness, building a reputation on the things you want to be known for, and then allowing yourself to be known for them. So I wanted to get into a little bit of a discussion about what that really means in terms of your brand and how that's going to be different from doing branding as like part of a company. So with your brand, you really have to decide who you want to be when you're out there in the space. So one thing I see a lot of people doing is they have two messages. So let's say, for example, you by day, you're a computer programmer, and by night, you're a network marketer, for example. A lot of times what I see in people's profiles is it tries to say both and it gets very confused in the message. So you definitely want to have a consistent message with your brand, like choose the brand that you want to work with and the platform that you want to work that on. And then if you do have something separate that you like to do on the side that you think also is a little bit of you, make sure that that brand is separate from your main brand, because people will see you and you kind of look disorganized and like you don't quite know what you're trying to do because your brand is all over the place. So it's like, you know, I cook and then, you know, I do a little programming and I do this, and people are kind of like, okay, I don't know what to hire you for because I don't know what you sell. Right. So you do definitely in branding, you want to make sure that you are selling your main item, the main thing, the main service that you offer. That's going to be the brand that you sell. And then if you want to do some stuff on the side, find appropriate channels to do that on with your brand. So, for example, I predominantly write resumes. I predominantly do LinkedIn profiles, cover letters, all things job related to personal branding. And I can also help small businesses with some of their personal branding. Now, I go to a certain extent, I'm not trying to jump all into that space, but if I already know like this kind of work this person does, this is the software they know how to use, these are the clients they've worked with, it's not that big of a jump to go from a resume to, say, a speaker bio or some kind of profile, or writing some copy for their website, right? Now, if I'm not necessarily trying to be a web designer, though. So in terms of like where I end, I'm a partner with a web designer that can then take the words that I put together and the general style of my client and then move them into the webosphere, right? And allow them to then move into, say, social media and other areas that might be of interest to them, right? So I kind of end somewhere, and I'm not trying to be a do-it-all shop. So that's a good example of sticking to your brand. Now, I do want to go back and share my next slide. Let's see if that works. Is the purpose, which is establishing yourself and enabling others to identify you. So when we think of companies like Coca-Cola, we think of other companies, we are looking at like brands in terms of, you know, I know Coke is sweet. I know that it is bubbly. I know that it's associated with fun. I know it's a longtime brand. I know that it's sold all over the world, right? And I know what Coke is. What you want to do on a smaller scale as a solopreneur is to take who you are and be that person, right? So when I'm Chantel Thompson or Chantel Sweet Job Spot, oh, I'm just realizing there's chat here. So so if anybody has any questions, feel free. Can you guys see me now? You said the screen was black. So can you see me now? Sorry about that. So sorry, I got to go back. Refresh. I got to refresh my browser. Okay. How do I do that? Okay. No, okay, you can see me.
You're fine. Yeah, yeah. Any of the participants, if your browser goes black, and this is unfortunately the issue with Hopin, just refresh your browser, press F5, and the video should pop back.
Okay, sorry. Yeah, because I was looking in the wrong chat. I was looking at our page chat, special speaker chat. but when you're doing your, when you're putting together your brand, there are a few things you want to do. One thing, if you haven't noticed this yet, most websites that do anything, whether it be LinkedIn, whether it be, and I'm going to show you, I haven't put mine together yet because I've been a little slow on this, so excuse me. But let's say you go to inclusion, right? So you can see the inclusion site, right? Okay, so there's a whole profile, and in here you've got your professional title, where you are, how many years of experience, what your rate is. You have this summary section. Now, your summary section that you have here should be very similar to your summary section that you have elsewhere. So your summary section on LinkedIn, your summary section on inclusion, your summary section on Upwork, on Fiverr, on your social media, right? Anything that you're using for company work should be, or you know, your service or your product that you're offering, it should be very similar. Does it have to be exactly the same word for word? Not necessarily, because different platforms speak a little differently. You may want to change you know, what you're talking about a little to for that audience, but your summary should be very similar in all cases, right? You should have all of this stuff, and the best thing I say for people to do is take all this stuff and put it in a text document. Go through and say, this is what I want, this is who I am, this is what I offer, this is how much I charge, and try to stay as consistent as possible, because when you're talking to people, if you're doing, say, if somebody's searching for you, and I got to, I want to show you this. If somebody is searching for you, you want them to really be able to find you and look you up and see what you know how to do and verify that you are who you say you are, right? So I'll give you an example. I'm going to look up Jabril because his name is very unique, right? So he's somebody you can find easily. If you don't have a unique name and you have an LLC, you may want to go ahead and use that LLC along with your name in everything that you do. So my name is moderately unique. Chantel Thompson is not that popular. It's, you know, it's not like Helen Smith or something, but it's still not unique enough for people to necessarily look me up and only find me. They may find some other people in there. So I usually stick with my brand, Sweet Job Spot, and a lot of my things say Sweet Job Spot. But if you look at his brand, what you'll see is you'll see a lot of consistency and you'll see him show up in many places. So he's in LinkedIn. He has inclusion there. You see him here on Twitter, live, his videos, live, and they all kind of point to the same place, the same person, the same brand. And if you look him up, he's got 700,000 results, right? So are they all him? Probably. But if you look at, you know, what he's done, it shows people, it gives you that credibility. So there are a lot of places you can go to get credibility. Medium is a great website that you can go and talk about what you know how to do. LinkedIn is also a great website that you can talk about what you know how to do as a subject matter expert. Now, in terms of a subject matter expert, it's up to you what you want to share with people. So first seven pages of Google are all you, and then it's somebody else. Is that what's going on, Jabril? Awesome. So I don't have quite as many. I probably have about 250,000. If I look up Chantel Thompson, Sweet Job Spot together, if it's just Chantel Thompson, there's some random stuff that might come up. So I don't know what happens with that. I usually stick with Sweet Job Spot because it makes it simple. Yes, so Ingrid is right. Definitely Google your name and see what comes up. And if it's not you, find a way to make yourself unique. Find a way to make yourself come up, right? So that when you're talking to other people, you can say, okay, find me and I'm this person, I am here. Should you also develop a personal website like a digital CV, Lanise? You can. I think it is helpful. I think that it's good to have some place for people to go to see what you know how to do. If your business and your personal are separate things, like let's say you sell CBD oil on the side, but your main business is you do web design. I mean, your main job that you're looking for is web design. Yes, you do want to have something separate. You could have a LinkedIn profile. You could do a .me page. You can just make your own website, which it's iffy if you want to work with it. I would say nothing's wrong with having your own website. It's just so easy to get lost in the sauce. And if you're not really promoting it, you're kind of doing all this work for something that you could just put on a LinkedIn profile. So, okay, so you have a consulting business. Yeah, having a resume is going to be very helpful for a consulting business. That way you can submit all your information, right? And make sure your resume has very relevant and specific information on it. So when I'm doing resumes, I like to make sure, that my clients are putting in quantitative as well as qualitative information. So if you've worked with a large client with a $2 million budget, you want to make sure that you're putting that in that profile so people know who you work with, what you do, what deliverables you had, and all of that. Sorry, I'm looking at the chat and trying to talk. It's weird. The other thing is, when, so we were talking about your name, looking yourself up, definitely do that. If you have anything more specific that you can look yourself up on, if you can promote yourself in a more specific way, let's say it's with your MBA, let's say it's with your PMP, let's say, you know, anything that you have, you do want to put that up there, right? And you want to go and determine what your services are, determine how much you charge, and separate. If they are very different, brand one of them that's like not under your name, right? Brand one of them that it's really about that business more so than maybe you, so that you don't get a lot of confusion, so people don't think. Yes, Medium is, it's a, the thing about Medium is you can blog there. So you can always blog on Medium and you can redirect people back to your site, get those backlinks. On LinkedIn, you can write articles. They're not read, however, as much as your posts. So writing an article, say, once a week and doing a post regularly is great. Writing the article is good because it'll have you show up more in search, right? So if people are looking for you and they want to say, who's Lanice Block? What does she do? They can Google you and then they'll see all your LinkedIn articles and they'll see who you are, right? In terms of what you write about, make sure what you're writing about is in line with your work. You can be social because it is social media. You don't have to be super worky all the time. I don't like to, it's a weird word to use, but sometimes people get a little too focused on being overly professional with no personality. So depending on the profile you're on, you can interject with a little personality, talk about your dog, talk about your kids, you know, talk about what you cooked for dinner here and there. But your overall message on a regular basis is going to be maybe talking about a use case study, really short, like I was working with a client and they didn't do this. And I showed them how to do this, and then this was the result, right? So using the STAR method, and I'll put this in the notes. The STAR method is a situation. If I could only spell it. Task, action, result. So make sure that's in the things that you're discussing. So all of your messages should be like that. All of your branding should be. You can go back to that and say, this is what I've done. This is who I've helped. These are the kind of clients I've worked with, right? Whether it's corporate and internal or private and external, B2B, B2C, you do want to put that in there. And then finally, the last thing is establishing yourself as an expert and enabling other people to identify with you. I do want to show you this slide that I have for that and why it is so important to get your brand together. So this is LinkedIn branding. So this is a good example. If you look here on the fact file, adding a profile photo, and make sure your profile photo is not cropped. It doesn't have other people in it or cropped out of it. There's no like arm here. It's not a profile of you at a wedding. It's not a profile of, you know, your work ID. So, you know, getting in a space with some light, preferably natural light, usually works the best for if you're going to DIY it, where you can clearly see your face. You want to go probably from about shoulders and above. It's fine. Most people, a lot of people are seeing you on their smartphones. So it's very hard to see you if you're far away and you have one of those long, like full body profiles. It works on the computer. It doesn't work so well on the phone. So people can't really see you. So make sure you have that. Your summary, like I said, that should be the same message pretty much everywhere. Members who include skills, make sure your skills are everywhere. Your industry, location, any education, any connections, any certificates are really going to be helpful too under that education, right? So certificates. And the best thing you want to do is be viewed by people and then really look at what are some things you could possibly do to connect with people. One thing that I see a lot of people, they're trying to sell. So the best thing to do if you're trying to brand yourself and make partnerships with people is really look at, okay, what do I do? What do you do? How can we work together to come over and really connect with each other? Because especially now in these times, solopreneurs, it's going to be a little different. So if there's somebody that you can partner with, if somebody you can, if there's somebody you can partner with, and if there's somebody that you can work in tandem, so you guys can sell each other's services, you can either refer to each other or you can create a package where you work both together at, you know, at a rate that works for your clients, that can really help. I see ZWD said you prefer separating your personal from your business, but you've been told it's a marketing nightmare. It really depends on the business and it depends on the personal. I don't know who runs Coca-Cola, but I could buy a Coke anytime, right? If your business is a service and it's you, then yeah, it's going to be really hard to disconnect that. If your business is just the service itself, and maybe you hire subcontractors and you hire other people, then you can really stick it to being the business itself. And, you know, you can be the face when you have to do things, but just like Jabril has inclusion, like even though I connect it with him, I can see it as a standalone brand, right? It's inclusion, it's something for Black and Latino, programmers, designers, data administrators, all that kind of stuff. So I could see it being separate from him and growing as its own entity, as its own business. So I would say that's what you want to do. If it's a service, what kind of service is it that you have? And how much of the service are you personally delivering? And is it something that you foresee somebody else delivering? That's my question, Z. So if you see somebody else being able to take it over and do it for you, so apparel technology, yeah, that could be you. That could be just your brand. It could be you when you're fundraising, when you're giving presentations, and it could be your brand when you're just doing straight up marketing, right? Straight up sales, straight up marketing. Here's my brand. This is what's available for sale. Yeah, some industries do have biases. And I don't know if I don't want to be going over time. We're about 30 minutes in. So,
We have about 5 minutes left. This has been a great, great, great presentation. Everyone who has presented so far, you know, my pitch to you all was a conversation, and you all came with all the full presentation packet ready and everything. So I appreciate that. I was ready to have a discussion, and once I saw these presentation packets, it was like, okay, well,
you're not.
If you do your thing, right? So I mean, this has been great around personal branding, because it asked Joy a question early on about how to. Freelancers, a lot of people who work remotely, they're introverts, right? Yeah. And I'm an introvert if I'm in the house. I'm an extrovert if I'm outside of the house. if anyone gets that. So if I'm in a networking situation, I'm fine. If I'm in the house, I'll stay in the house. So this whole quarantine thing, no issue for me. But see, the thing is that there are a lot of people who, no matter what, they're introverts, inside or out. And talking to people, physically talking to people, is hard for them. So personal branding is very important. Setting up those ways where even if people reach to you or that connection is made, it isn't a cold call or a cold engagement. Because a lot of times those cold engagements are the things that cause anxiety for people, yeah. Especially if they're introverts, right? You know, if it's a warm engagement, it's different then. So this is important, a lot of the nuggets you've been dropping.
Yeah, and you know, what I found, because I myself, I know there's a difference. I think I heard somebody say flexivert. So it's kind of an introvert, extrovert. I'm kind of a flexivert because I'm a programmer by trade. I do databases and things like that. I can also sell things to people. And I found that 99% of my sales is better when I know what I'm selling, right? Mm-hmm. So a lot of times, if you don't know what you're selling, that's why I say decide what you're gonna sell first. Because if you don't decide what you're gonna sell first, you can be taken in a bunch of different directions, right? So if you actually promote your brand, it can do a portion of the selling for you. And then what I like to do is I actually have I have created templates for my sales. So that's in a whole nother, that's doing your sales platform and all that stuff. But I would suggest, if you know who you are and you know what you want to sell, start creating templates to answer those questions that you get all the time or that you think people are going to ask you, and start putting those out there in Gmail. You can create templates and keep them on the side, and then you can just click on them and it'll fill out the whole auto. It's kind of like an auto response. And then you just make a few edits and send it out, and it seems to work pretty well. The same thing with your sales or your marketing pitch. Having some kind of template really does help. And even, you know, I wrote notes for what I was talking about today. Write notes and use them. And put them, you know, you can put them right here on your screen. You can get a little clip, put them right on your screen, put them right in front of you when you talk. It'll really calm down the nervousness and give you some talking points. So when you are talking, you can, you know, just stick with the subject and not get so worried about, oh, did I say this or that? So that definitely helps.
I'll tell you that, you know, the whole personal branding thing, and it's thanks for feeding into my little small amount of narcissism with the Googling me, because I have been big on that, big on Googling and making sure that, you know, I have some type of presence there. And it, sometimes it gets addictive. How many pages can I go back, right, as far as that goes? And so I appreciate that nugget as well that you dropped. We are wrapping things up on with you. I appreciate you coming on today. I appreciate your presentation.
Yeah.
We're going to send out contact links to everyone. I think it's so many. I've already gone on and scheduled a time with Kimberliann because getting taxes done. So hopefully, just real quick, put out your social media. Can they connect you with you on Twitter or LinkedIn? Let us know.
Yeah. As I said, you kind of know I'm Sweet Job Spot. So let's see.
Sweet Job Spot. Everywhere, right?
Sweet Job Spot everywhere, man.
There we go.
If you want to connect with me personally on LinkedIn, I'm under Chantel S. Thompson. But if you want to connect on any kind of social media or anything like that, if you Google Sweet Job Spot, you'll find me. If you Google Chantel Thompson at Sweet Job Spot, you'll find me there too. So. Yeah.
Sounds good.
Pretty straightforward. I try to stick with it. And one last thing I did want to say to people, you will likely get to a point where you're like, I'm not sure I love my brand, until you have like truly decided that you want a different brand. Stick with it just for like the consistency sake. And don't worry so much about what it's called, or did you pick the perfect brand, or I don't like the color, or whatever, because you can get stuck in some of the wrong things. And that's one big thing. Privacy issues, I don't know. I try not to put my social security number out there.
But everything else is fair game, right, as far as brand.
My mother's maiden name and my social security number, I try to just keep those to myself. Everything else, I don't know. People can find you if they really want to.
Exactly. Yeah. Thanks, right, Chantel, for coming on. I appreciate it. And we're going to get all the information out in regards to Chantel as well. But next up, we're going to have Sheffie Robinson to come on. And Sheffie, as soon as you press the join button there, I've accepted you. We can get you on.
Hello.
Hi.
Apologize for the lighting. It's awful in my house, but we'll make it work.
Oh, no, it's no problem at all. No problem at all. So, Sheffie, you're here to talk about being the leading in, what is it, joining teams and contract freelancing and leading as being part of a team, right? So, if you want to give a quick background about yourself, do you have a presentation also? Or are we going to have?
I don't. I've been presenting all week, and I've literally been like, when you present for me, I feel disconnected a little bit. So no, I want to get into the questions with people, and I definitely want to, you know, impart as much information particular to their needs as possible. So a little bit of background on me. I am the CEO of Tuco Direct. We just launched our new brand, WP Clover. And I started my entire company as a freelancer 5 years ago. Started as a first-time mom, two-month-old, and my husband didn't want me to go back to work. And I'm like, well, I'm not sitting around here, so what can I do? And I started freelancing with virtual assistant services, and then I pretty much put my software development background out there and started bringing in clients. You know, one thing I found very quickly in that process is the bigger I appeared to be to the client, the more they trusted me and the more they were likely to continue doing business with me. One of my very first clients 5 years ago is still a client to this day because I was able to not only fix her problem that one time, but continue working with her in a way that I got a retainer. I mean, she pays me every month and has been paying me every month for 5 years. So, you know, that's the goal is to, when you have that first client, you have that first gig, how do you get them to continue paying you? Because that's how you grow from being a one-person shop to currently we're a 10-person company. So it's pivotal at this point, but yeah, that's me.
That's awesome. But see, and You've done a lot, and I can relate a lot, right? So, and that's amazing. I mean, because you had even a boot camp set up for this.
I did,
right? And so many things, and that's how I first, you know, that's like when I moved here to Atlanta at the end of 2016. That's how you were able to land on the radar that I had out there was because of that. You know, right. So providing ecosystems and structure around developing companies. But in this case, we're talking about developing those freelancers and these remote workers, right? So that's correct. Awesome. Eb, you're back online as well. So welcome back.
Hello. Hi, Sheffie.
Hello, dear. How are you?
Doing great. You said something that was music to my ears of, you know, getting money up front as much as possible. And yeah, we can go into that into a whole lot of conversations. So welcome.
Thank you.
So give me a little bit of background on regards to your that first step as a freelancer, that first jump into freelancing. How was it for you? And how, and the next other part of that is, how was that transition to becoming a business owner? Because that's one of the things we want to focus on with inclusion is there's going to be this generation of freelancers, people just doing right. on Fiverr and stuff like that, that become a business. But the first step is that freelancing.
My first couple of gigs, I mean, one thing, and this is true for most freelancers of color, I completely devalued my experience. I completely devalued my expertise. And I came in way under where I needed to be. I mean, like my first billable rate for software development was like $20 an hour. And
why?
Because I didn't think I could do better.
It's a mindset.
It is. It really is. For one, I'm a Black woman. I'm completely self-taught. I've been programming now for 20 years. I have never taken a single class on it. All of it I learned myself. And I'm a software engineer. So I'm coming in it with the mindset of people are going to expect me to have a degree. They're going to expect me to have all of this other stuff. Well, $20 is all I'm worth. And I had a conversation with one of my earlier customers and I quoted my price and they said, that's all. And it clicked in me like,
I'm below industry average here. Mm-hmm. And I'm in the United States. It's not like I'm in Pakistan or the Philippines where people are expecting to pay $20. People were expecting to pay $50-$60 for a WordPress developer.
Right.
So once I got over that hurdle, I'm like, all right, well, let me charge more. My invoices start getting paid more. Now my billable rate's $125 an hour. I have no problem getting an invoice paid, not a single one. But when I was doing $120 websites, people want the world and then didn't want to pay you any money for it. So it's like when you start determining your own personal value in the services that you offer, people start trusting, okay, well, they know what they're talking about. Their rate is industry standard, or sometimes it may be a little bit above. I'm paying for what I'm getting. And at that point, you'll start bringing in a different type of client. You'll bring in a client that's going to pay you what you're worth and won't have a problem with your invoice.
Now, by asking that why, but let's get back to the nitty gritty of that transition into freelancing and the issues around that, and then we're gonna get back to that other part around the magic of being a business.
Okay. So wait.
So you were talking why? About that, and then I asked why in regards to you devaluing yourself.
This is true. Okay, so in that transition from a freelancer into a business, I just started to look at my business and what were things that were time sinks for me. Of course, this was my full-time job as a freelancer, but at the same time, in order to progress to where I needed to go, I couldn't be the only one doing the work. So I hired another freelancer. This is my virtual assistant. She handled all of my social media. She handled a lot of my client contacts. She did my marketing. So that allowed me to sell and actually do the work. And then from there, I continued to hire additional freelancers. Now, one thing I do in my business that a lot of companies don't for freelancers, because a lot of companies honestly take advantage of freelancers, I offer a track for my freelancers to go to the next level. How can I help you be a business? Yes, you may work for me as a developer or a marketer or something like that, but I'm sure you have some goals for your freelancing. What can I do to help you? And one of my first freelancers, her company is called Christina Virtual. She started with me 3 years ago and she outpriced me. I can't afford her anymore. Because I allowed her to, you know, a place to kind of grow. Mm-hmm. And so that she can turn her freelance company into a business. And then it just kind of trailed off from there. We went from servicing just small businesses as a company to servicing enterprise clients. At that point, dealing with enterprise clients, I have to have a team. I have to have a CFO. I have to have a CMO. So things like that. So you get to that point where you realize if I want to go to the next step, I have to bring on additional people. Let me reach back and grab somebody just like somebody did for me.
Right.
So that I think is pivotal, especially in a realm where we're having so many people of color going into freelancing. How can we help each other build businesses? It's not just about how can you help my business. It's about how can I help you while you're helping my business.
Right, right. You know, and I love that point because that's one of the things that business person myself as a small business owner, then launching into my first kind of tech venture and then working with the African American Chamber of Commerce in my hometown. I've had this focus on how do we provide. With the chamber, it was economic development for Black-owned businesses and the women-owned businesses and Latino-owned businesses that we coordinated with through the chamber. But then it became a focus of economic empowerment, right, for individuals, right? And so that's one of the things that, you know, we're actively trying to continue to do as well, build ecosystems. And what you've done with providing economic development empowerment for entrepreneurs, right, that are in tech and so forth. So I love that point. How long did you freelance before you actually became a business?
Honestly, I say I was a business from day one, and anybody telling me different, they don't know what they're talking about. I mean, yes, I may have been the only employee, but I'm still a business. And I did that from day one. To co-direct was who I was. I didn't position it as Sheffie Robinson. I positioned me as Sheffie Robinson, president of Tuco Direct. So that's important, because the more you start off with a business mindset, the quicker you are to make that transition. I didn't hire my first person for the first probably year and a half. And then I went balls to the wall in 2016 and hired a whole bunch of people and ended up firing everybody because the company culture was just off. And at that point, I was small enough to just start over. Because one thing I want to always be in any business I'm involved in, I am anti-corporate. And the reason I say that is our corporate mindset has led us down a path where work-life balance doesn't exist. Our work and our lives exist around our jobs versus our lives exist with our talents. Right. So I've been, you know, if I see the company culture going in a way from a work-life balance, shutting it down. And I'll run it all by myself until I find the right team. But that's an aside. But yes, it was about a year and a half until I kind of understood the freelance realm for my industry. Because initially when I came in, I was just doing virtual assistant services. I didn't even believe in my own technical ability. I didn't even do it. I didn't even put myself out there initially. About 6 months in, I did my first project, and one of my first development clients, the one I told you is still with me to this day, I did her work on her website, and then she says to me, "Do you maintain websites too?" Absolutely, I sure do. I did not, but that day I did. And that woman and her just asking me if I did something led to me creating WP Clover to this day. So I created my first retainer plan with her because that was a need she had. And that turned into a whole business. So it goes back to that, you know, what we learn in startups, listening to your customer needs. The solution doesn't matter. It matters if you're solving their problem. So I directly created a process to solve her problem. And that led me into, okay, now I have a consistent amount of customers. Now I need a team.
Awesome. 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 And Eb, if you have any questions, go ahead.
I have to appreciate, because the one thing that I keep hearing from you, and correct me if I'm wrong, is always finding ways of empowering people, you know, like you said, reaching back. And I have to appreciate that you don't have that crab mentality, because it, in a lot of ways, especially working with certain people, I mean, I'm not originally from Atlanta. So when I first came here, it was very cliquish. And at that time, I was managing artists. I used to manage artists. So it's like, dude, we're like in this, what? I have to go back to the mindset of us not feeling threatened to help each other. That's just flat out. You know, we can't get to the next level if we're being stingy. So I have to put that out there that I appreciate that about you, because
thank you.
There is a whole lot of people that may not be willing to, you know, help your freelancer surpass you. That is unheard of in some instances, you know? And so my question to you, and I do see that there have been some questions that I don't want us to overlook. So let me ask you those really quickly.
Sure.
Hold on, I think everybody added some more really quick. But to really go into whatever was there. Okay, I see it. So Ro wants to know, can you tell us more about the types of automations your company and WP Clover does for freelancers? Yes. I'm glad you asked that, Ro, because again, I'm very big on processes and procedures. If your processes and procedures ain't in place, you losing money.
Yes.
And yeah. You can always go through, even though you're that one person working your company, the automations is technically your team. And we don't even look at it that way. The automation can be put in place to take the place of a warm body in a chair, yep. You know, clocking billable hours. Yes, you may be paying a monthly fee, but consider that monthly fee your billable hour that you're paying to someone else. So again, her question is, can you tell us more about the types of automations your company does for freelancers?
Yes. So one of the first automation systems I ever used as a freelancer was 17 Hats. I moved away from it these days, but 17 Hats was pivotal because it handled lead generation, it handled email automation, even my task list. I connected that with Asana, which is what we use internally for project management. And every time a lead came in, I use a Zapier, push it right to my Asana, bam, I got all the information I need right there. So even if I did bring in one person to help out, they already have the access they need to that information. It allows us all to do things a lot faster. Zapier is huge in our workflows. We connect it with our Google Drive, with all of our support systems so that everything's talking to everything at the same time and everybody gets information they need. When you start to grow to a point where you're realizing you're starting off your morning with 30 emails, it's time to automate. Just because you'll be inundated with emails and not respond to customers fast enough. 17 Hats was wonderful. I switched to Dubsado recently. Their automations are great. There's only a couple of different features between the two, but Zapier was still key for everything. So I have a system that houses customer information, which is a CRM. So that's 17 Hats or Dubsado. I have the project management solution, which is we use Asana. Some people are comfortable with Trello and a couple of the other ones. Asana is free. You can do a lot with it, even on the free plan. I ended up upgrading to business, but that's just because our team is a little bit large. Either way, having an email that automatically sends them their contracts without you having to manage all of that, it takes like an hour off of your day because you don't realize how much time you spend on those tasks until they're automated. And the first thing that a lot of people do when they go into this, they're like, man, it's going to take me 3 hours to set this up. It does. It absolutely does.
Right.
But you'll save 20 hours on the back.
Correct. And even knowing when to hire someone, because even with me, I edit podcasts and transcribe and all that other stuff, but I wouldn't be able to sit on the line with you guys if I'm still editing. So I hired someone and my executive assistant, I have two people that I hired. I have one person editing and then my executive assistant, because she has time with everything else, she's transcribing as well. So kind of separating duties from there. But even like you said, find the tools that are comfortable for your business needs. I'm a Zoho One girl. Like Zoho talks to everything all at once.
Yeah, great. Zoho's great.
So I would encourage everyone to really start going out there and saying, this is what my business is from day to day. What does that look like? Brian has a great question as well. He says, what strategies do you use to position your value as a freelancer versus the no-cost, affordable, do-it-yourself tools and apps, i.e. Fiverr, Squarespace, etc.?
Time. The number one reason a person comes to a freelancer is because they don't have the time. The second reason is they don't know how. It's a matter of showing them the value you provide to them and allowing them to save time. The biggest reason I hired additional freelancers was like, hey, I need to sell. I can't be in code and be on, Twitter and do LinkedIn and code and sell. I just don't have enough time in the day. I'm a mom. I'm a wife. I have three kids and a little one, a five-year-old. You know how much kids talk.
Right.
So it's like, I don't have the time in the day to do it. And that's why people hire you. So if you can come in and say, okay, well, I can take this from you. I'll save you about, 50 hours a month in time with the 10 hours you're paying me. How much is that worth to you?
Right.
Most people that know business know it's worth it.
Right. So you touched a great point, especially in the time of quarantine. We have parents that are freelancers, business owners. So before it was, okay, I'm going to drop little John off at school. I have X amount of time to get work done. The house is quiet, or I can go to the co-chair working space. But now everybody's in one house.
Right,
like,
girl.
And the one house. So it's like, I need to do this, I need to do this, but then it's like toys and all this other stuff. And it's like, what just happened? So how would you encourage us on the line that may be dealing with that? Is this a great time to really step back to say, start looking at your day-to-day? What can you automate? What can you delegate? What can you get rid of? Because sometimes we hold on to tasks, and that task may be so like minute or asinine at this moment that it's costing you 30 minutes of billable time versus getting rid of it because you can, versus right. keeping it. And it's like, oh, I could have gotten to step C in one less step than, you know what I mean? So talk mm-hmm. to that for those that are trying to juggle a whole lot right now.
So number one thing I did was start scheduling. Our first week into this thing, we had the kids getting up at their same time for school that they got up normally, and that turned into a nightmare because my husband was on his calls, I'm on my calls, and then all the kids were here too. So we pretty much was like, okay, from 7 a.m. till 10, that's just us being right. you know, Sheffie and Terry. Then the kids come in, we'll stop, we'll pause for lunch, we'll even have family recess where we go in the front yard and throw the Frisbee around. That's our kind of like our downtime. And then we come back in and we work. So it's a lot of planning, a lot of making sure the kids have little tasks that they can do. My 5-year-old, he has Google Classroom. He has his laptop. He does his work. The teenagers do their work. So we're all working at the same times, and then we all pause at the same times.
Right.
Reason that works is because if you pause at different times, then your kids are bugging you while you're trying to work.
Right.
So trying to keep that together as much as possible. As far as your automation processes, consistently look at what that looks like. I look at our automation processes at least once a month just to see where holes are, where they can be filled, where we might be trying to do too much, because I have a couple of those too where I'm doing
that. Or if it's even working, because sometimes right. they like set it and forget it, and you can't set it and forget it. We're not cooking chicken right now. We're literally running a business, so we have to check it.
Right.
Time,
you know? Right. Absolutely. And another big one to help me, I turned off notifications from Facebook and all social media. During my day, it's all off. If yes. I pause for a second and I want to check my phone to see what's going on LinkedIn or Facebook, or I do my shenanigans, then I look at it then. But notifications was a huge way to be distracted. Same thing with email. You can pause your email just to not bother with it for a few while you work.
Right.
Finding those quiet hours during the day where everybody else is busy, those are the times to start planning out your automations. Write it down first. Don't try to jump into a system and do it. Write it down, map it out. Okay, this is the first email they're gonna get. Then I'm gonna send them an email with a PDF. Then if they connect, if they respond, I'll send this email. If they don't respond, I'll send that. Map out what you want to see and what you want to happen. What do you want to happen before you do it? If you try to jump into the system, you'll end up taking longer.
Right.
But yeah, during this time, lots and lots of planning. And if you have a family, more family time. You really have the opportunity to have more family time. You just have to make sure you're making your work time more efficient by eliminating the things that that you know take you away from your job.
Yeah. So that is very great, because, and I would even say for those that do have kids, because I'm a process person, I would literally say throw it on the wall. Yep. Take that time to invest in a whole bunch of sticky notes and write step one. What is that step one? Put it on the wall. Throw everything on the wall. And if you want to, you know, entertain the kids, say no, move this one in front of step three and all that other stuff, because as you said,
absolutely,
it's a time or whatever else, but it's giving you the bigger picture of what that process looks like. And a lot of people may need to understand that the moment they hit your website just for an inquiry form, it's not just answering or whatever else, it's the input. What is your determined output? And from an, you know, and speak on that from an automation perspective, because some people just think that it's like, we're just putting this in, not considering the back end piece and the output right. of what happened, the turnaround times. Like, we can't say we're not answering an email that automatically came in until 3 days later. So speak on that.
So one big piece is, like you said, developing what you want people to do. If you want them to just know who you are as a brand, then you may have a specific workflow that's just introducing the brand. If you want them to actually lead, if you want them to actually buy at that point, you have to know the fundamentals of a sales funnel and how people move through your funnel. You know, at the top of the funnel, they're just learning about who you are as a company. They may or may not buy at that point,
right.
But then you have to nurture them on through the funnel. Now they know who you are. All right, let's speak directly to the information they came here for. If you're a graphic designer and they're looking for logos, all right, specific information about creation of logos and why that's important. It could be so much as, you know, teaching them a little bit about branding, you know, business cards, things of that nature. And then as they go down from there, they're probably still hunting because they're looking at different options. Why are you the best option? You need right. information out there telling them that too. And then through the sales process, okay, now they signed on to say schedule an appointment with me, or they've bought a service. Now I need to reach out to them for onboarding. Your onboarding needs a workflow too. You have them in the sales funnel. Now you got to onboard them. While they're onboard, once they're onboarded, you know, whatever that may, that could be a conversation with us. It's a conversation with them. And then we start setting up their website in the system. After onboarding, then they go into our retention funnel. You're still in a funnel.
Right.
And you have to continue that with, you know, with your customer to nurture them through your entire business process. So once they're onboarded in the system, they probably pay their first month. They're rolling through things. Okay, let me check in 7 days. How are things going?
Right.
You know, we received our information. Let's talk about any issues you may have. 30 days. Is everything still okay? 90 days. Just checking in. 1 year. You've been with us a year now. How are things going?
Right.
Consistent check-ins is what keeps people in with working with a company. I can look at, you know, some of my very early clients. They'll tell you, I've been paying consistently for a year, may not have had to use the services very much, but Sheffie stays in touch.
Yep.
Tuco stays in touch. So, because that's what people are looking for, especially when you're doing any type of retainer work. They want to know that if they need you right now, they're there. Because if you don't do that, then they feel like I'm paying for a service I don't even need.
Right.
And you want them to need you. You do. That's your business. Because if they don't need you, they won't pay for it.
Right.
But if you're, you know, have a retainer product where they're, you know, they may pay for 10 hours a month and only use two. They're still paying for 10, but that two, it's still valuable to them to still have you there, even if they're not using the bulk of what you're offering. So it's important to maintain contact, let them know you're still in business, and they become your champions.
Right.
They become they refer you to people. So communication in your whole automation process from the time they're introduced to you to the time they become a customer and while they're a customer is important.
Right. And you really touched on the nurture sequence of what I call it on, from my coaching aspect, it really speaks volumes if you send Sarah an email to say, hey, I know that your dog Chip had surgery last week. How did it go? And yeah. We sometimes think that, you know, why would I want to get in somebody's personal business? You know, especially our culture, it's like what happens in your house and, you know, stays. But now is that time to really break down those barriers and get to know your client. Because if you knew that your client was someone that was emailing you on a consistent basis and all of a sudden they dropped, you know, communication, that would be your red flag. Hey, something's going on with Sarah. Follow up with Sarah. Find out that Chip got hit by a car and he needed to get surgery. And I'm just using the dog because it's common and not that we're, you know, promoting animal abuse or anything else. Mm-hmm. I want to put that out there. But it's the small things that really count. So,
right.
Definitely great information. Jabil, did you have anything else?
So one thing, drop that gem in regards, and I know the topic was around especially leading as a freelancer, remote worker, especially on the team, if you were to join the team. just get a bit of information that kind of summarizes that point, especially around the topic really quickly.
So a lot of freelancers kind of devalue their work just because they're not attached to a corporate entity. We don't need corporate entities to tell us how amazing we are. So when you step into a realm where you're a freelancer on a team, even if you are working with a corporate entity, you're a professional. They brought you in for a specific expertise. It wasn't a job. It's an expertise, and you approach it like a right. consultant. You know, don't necessarily approach it like, well, I'm just a worker. No, they specifically chose you for this specific task.
Right.
You're a consultant. Consultants get paid more too. So if you approach it where your expertise is the reason you're there, you're not there to just be a body, like typically in jobs, because you know, in a job, they'll typically hire anybody just to fill a role. But in a freelance case, they're looking specifically for a expertise. Right. Approach it like a consultant, even on the team. You're the expert in that particular field that you came in there. So if, you know, one thing, and I had this with an earlier client, I was with this client for almost 2 years, and they brought me in. Of course, my expertise shined. I rebuilt their entire customer service department and then started developing their website as well. But the VP kind of got a bug in her something, and she just started kind of treating me like I didn't know what I actually knew, micromanaging me and things like that. And I had to remind her, I'm not an employee. I am a contractor. You hired me for my expertise. If you do not feel like my expertise is fitting to the company, then we'll have another conversation. And I ended up having to walk away from that contract. It was at the time a significant amount of my monthly income, but I made 3 times that a month later.
Wow. Yeah.
You have to, you know, determine when you are, when somebody is trying to devalue the expertise you brought to the role. And sometimes you got to walk away because the time and effort you save by not having to deal with somebody who's approaching you in an erroneous way is time and effort you could put into right. a customer, into a client that values who you are.
It's amazing. I think that was a great, that was the gem of all, that was the diamond right there. That was the diamond in regards to,
thank you.
To summarizing that topic and relaying your experience. Sheffie, it's been great having you on. I mean, this is me. We've talked a few times by phone, but to really get to understand your expertise, it's amazing. And I think that you provided a great value for everyone else that's listening as well as part of this conference. So I really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Have anything else?
No.
Any other questions?
I just have to, you know, go and tip my hat off to you and everything else. I didn't see anything else coming in. I did see a lot of agreement a lot of co-signing, email automation versus check-ins, and a lot of hundreds and dropping jewels. So thank you. You're speaking my language.
Thank you. No problem. All right. Well, you guys enjoy the rest of your day, and I appreciate you having me on.
Likewise.
Thank you.
All right. That was great. We had 5 great women panelists, professionals of color, Black women, Latino women that were on dropping these gems. So I want to let everybody know before you drop off, we're going to have the DJ to come back in spinning. But I just opened up if you refresh your page on the left-hand side, there's a tab called Sessions. So I opened up 2 session rooms where 20 people by video can connect all in one room. So if you want to keep networking, definitely go over and click on the Sessions link. Otherwise, you can go back to the main stage as well to continue to listen to DJ Knotts, spin a little bit more. If you're missing out on DJ Nice or any of your other normal DJ events that goes on Instagram right now, finish catching up on DJ Knotts and listen to his spinning. Otherwise, you want to have some closing remarks here, Eb, in regards to
I just have to thank everybody for the support, from the speakers to everyone that chimed in. I mean, we did not have a dead chat at all. So thank you. Thank you. Thank you for, you know, just joining in. And this is not going to be the last one. Definitely join us in the community. I've put the link out there. You know, feel free again to send us individual messages or, you know, whatever. We have cleaned it up a lot because we are over 500 people in the community. So we want to make sure that you are in your playing grounds, if that makes sense. So if you're a graphic designer, we have a spot for you and everything else. Yeah, Sheffie just put her information out there. We're going to repost it in the community. But all I can say is thank you, and I look forward to the next one.
And anyone who's interested in becoming a speaker, I just opened the link back up. So if you go back to flex-con.co, that'll take you to Linktree. There's the link again for sponsors, exhibitors, speakers. One of the things that Sheffie, she's offering a discount with her web hosting services. That will be posted. But in hindsight, she should have been an exhibitor. We didn't have many exhibitor requests this time. So anyone who's definitely interested, you don't have to be hiring necessarily remote freelancers right now. If we have a chance to promote Black and Brown businesses as exhibitors, as free exhibitors right now, then we will definitely do that as well, for you to come in. So, and then, like I said, head over. If you want to listen to DJ Not Spin, great. Otherwise, you can also, if you refresh your page and go and click on the sessions button to click a pop-up, and you should be able to automatically jump into a session with 20 other people that are attending right now. And there's two groups, so there's still enough. There's enough room for two sessions for everybody to still continue on the chat afterwards. All right, so we are gonna bring up DJ Knotts, man. DJ, man, it's been great listening to you, man.
Thank you, sir.
We appreciate it.
Astro.
There you go.
I lost your sound, but I can read what you're saying. I'm ready.
Sun is down, freezing cold.
That's, oh yeah. Give some trap music.
That's just all he know, he don't know nothing else. I tried to show him. Yeah. I tried to show him. Yeah. 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 Gone on you with a pick and roll. Yellow flame in sickle mode. To the dance. Yeah. Now I hit that FBO with duffels in my hand.